subscribers at these locations.
The following is a presentation of ESPN on ABC.
Welcome, everyone, to the Cotton Bowl in Dallas, Texas, in the 110th edition of the Red River Rivalry, one of the great rivalries in all of college football, which dates back to 1900. It's been played here in Dallas since 1929, the State Fairgrounds of Texas, the midway point between the two campuses in Austin, Texas, and Norman, Oklahoma. The Oklahoma Sooners take the field. They arrive with a record of 4-0 and have moved up to number 10 in the country this week. And welcome to Dallas. I'm Sean McDonough along with Chris Spielman, the College Football Hall of Famer, and we're joined down on the field by Todd McShay. I hope Todd can hear us in this deafening noise of the Cotton Bowl. Todd, Oklahoma's expectations starting the year not as high as in recent years. They didn't know what they'd get from Baker Mayfield, their quarterback, and boy, he's been terrific and a big part of their success.
He has a walk-on who transferred, and he's a perfect fit in Lincoln Riley, the new offensive coordinator's system. They really love how he's improved each and every week, and I think the first thing that jumps out when you watch the tape, his ability to extend plays. Here you see patience in the pocket, feels the outside rush, keeps his eyes down the field. He's going to elude that one rusher by climbing. Then he's going to work to his left, locating the receiver down the field. How about this throw? Right down the sideline, perfect spot. The next thing that jumps out is he's improving pre-snap recognition. Here you're going to see the safeties shaded over to the left. He's got trips to the right with three defenders. That's the side he wants to go. He's going to attack the matchup he wants, which is his number two receiver on a corner route, and just drops it in perfectly. Now, for Texas to have a chance today, they need a great front four pass rush. If not, this is a matchup that's not going to work out very well for the Longhorns. The receivers of Oklahoma going up against that Longhorn secondary.
It is a Texas team that has really struggled on and off the field. On the field, they're 1-4. Their worst start through five games since 1956. In fairness, they've played a very difficult schedule. The four teams they lost to are all in the top 25 this week. But regardless of that, Chris, it's a mess right now.
Yeah, it is, and there's a lot of distractions. One, they're having player-only meetings. Player-only meetings accomplish nothing. You sit around and talk about what you should have done. The other thing, you look at it, you have meetings about tweets. You have to have some responsibility. You have your underclassmen blaming upperclassmen blaming lowerclassmen. There has to be one leader and one voice. There's only one man responsible for this program and to get it turned around, and that's Charlie Strong. The other thing, Sean, if things go bad, this team can't go into the tank. They got to fight their way through it and show that they're mentally tough.
Charlie Strong and the Texas Longhorns, a team in desperate need of a huge win. A chance for that today in this great rivalry game. The kickoff from Dallas right after this. Beautiful day here in Dallas. The temperature as we approach kickoff in the low 70s. Not a cloud in the sky. Very little wind to speak of as well. Texas won the toss and elected to defer. So Oklahoma will receive the opening kickoff. Sooners coached by Bob Stoops in his 17th year as head coach at Oklahoma. 10-6 against this rival. Winners of four of the last five. Although they were outplayed for much of last year's game, statistically Texas dominated. One of the key elements of that game last year was a kickoff return for a touchdown by Alex Ross of Oklahoma. He's back deep to receive the opening kickoff from Nick Rose. And another touchback for Rose, who's done a great job picking off this year. More than 67% of his kickoffs have gone for touchbacks. So here's the Oklahoma offense, led by Baker Mayfield, the junior, grew up in Austin, not far from the University of Texas campus. Walked on at Texas Tech and as a true freshman, won the starting quarterback job and was the conference offensive freshman of the year. But then decided to transfer. He wasn't happy in Lubbock. Sat out last year. and has had an outstanding year this year. Eighth in the country in passing yards per game, sixth in total offense, and off the big performance in their win at home last week against West Virginia. High-powered Oklahoma attack, 10th in the country in scoring, 10th in passing. They've gone to more of a passing attack with the new coordinator this year. They come out swinging, Mayfield deep, and a flag thrown. Looking for A.D. Miller. And the coverage from John Bonney.
Part of Oklahoma's offense and something that Baker Mayfield.
Pass interference by number 24 of the defense. It's a 15-yard penalty, and it's a first down.
Has done well this year, has tacked the field, attacked the field deep, puts a lot of pressure on the defense, and is moving forward. You look at Texas's defense, their strength is the front four. The weakness of the Oklahoma offense is the offensive line.
Penalty to the 40-yard line, 15 yards from the line of scrimmage. Texas rushes five. Mayfield throws. His intended receiver, Sterling Shepard, stumbled out of his cut. He's their leading receiver, but Chris, a big difference in this Oklahoma offense this year. More weapons around him out wide for Mayfield.
Mayfield does such a good job of recognizing matchups that he likes with those various receivers and usually delivers strikes on time.
Completing 65% of his passes this year. Texas brings a blitz. Mayfield swings it away from it. Was it a catch? Jarvis Baxter couldn't hang on. It's ruled an incomplete pass. The junior from Garland, Texas, a little bit too anxious to run.
Well, they had numbers out there. You can see they have a hat on a hat, two on two, where defenders to blockers. If he catches that, he's off.
Third down and 10, the huge problem for Texas this year, the third down defense. Oklahoma's offense has been ordinary, but Texas is 122nd in the country on third down defense. Their opponents converting nearly 53% of the time. A lot of people standing on that Texas D. Mayfield's a good runner, but he gets only two. Tripped up by Puna Ford. And on fourth down and 8, the punting team comes on for Oklahoma.
Really good job by Texas disguising coverage and what they wanted to do. They were even able to get their cornerback Duke Thomas up near the line. It looked like he might be coming on a B-gap blitz. He doesn't, drops into coverage. I think it really confused Mayfield in that look.
Austin Seibert, a true freshman, handling both the punting and place kicking. He's been tremendous. And there's another excellent punt. Duke Thomas made the fair catch. 46-yard kick. The only true freshman of the country handling both punting and place kicking. Jerod Hurd is the Texas quarterback up the road, Denton, out of Denton Geyer High School. Terrific performance against Cal, broke Vince Young's single game school record for total offense. So the other end of the spectrum in their 50-7 loss last week at TCU. Just 71 yards of total offense. He threw for 48 yards in that game. Texas offense averaging 24.6 per game. Hurd on target on his first throw of the day to Andrew Beck. And the tight end battles for every yard to the 17-yard line.
Really like the call by Jay Norvell to get the young freshman settled in and give him some confidence on an easy out throw. And Beck, a tight end that has not caught a lot of balls this year, getting involved to maybe occupy the Sooners, at least mentally, knowing they have to account for 47 Beck.
His second catch of the year, good for a 3-yard gain. Design run for Hurd. And well defended. Dominique Alexander, the linebacker, second team All Big 12 a year ago, and leading the Big 12 in tackles this season at 10 per game.
Dominique's got really good instincts, Sean. Not a big take-on guy, but he does make plays sideline to sideline.
Third down and 7. On a delay, the inside handoff. Deontay Foreman will check that. Jonathan Gray, the ball carrier, tackled by Charles Tapper. And it'll be a Texas three and out.
And that was a big play for them last week, where Foreman did have success against TCU's defense. Oklahoma's done its scouting report, understanding that that was their most successful running play versus the Horned Frogs.
Sterling Shepard back for the punt. Michael Dixon, a short kick and a running fair catch made near the 48-yard line. Each team has had it once, and each team has punted. A 33-yard punt for Michael Dixon. We're back in Dallas for the Red River Rivalry 110th meeting. Texas leads all time, but Oklahoma's won four of the last five. The winner gets the Golden Hat Trophy. It was originally the bronze hat. But when the hat was refigured, reworked in the 1970s, it came back gold, so they changed it to the Golden Hat. It's one of the unique features. The fans given seats 50-yard line to 50-yard line. So as you look down, the Oklahoma people to the right of your screen from our camera angle. Tough run. Samaje Perine ahead for about five. He hasn't been quite as involved in the offense this year. They've gone to more of a throwing attack with Lincoln Riley, a new offensive coordinator. They go quickly, and it's into the bag of tricks for a reverse. Edie Westbrook tackled by Bryce Cottrell, and a loss on the play back across midfield to the 49-yard line.
Mental mistakes are being limited so far early in this ball game by the defense of Texas, doing their responsibility, guys running the football and finishing against the speedy D.D. Westbrook. But that's been the problem that defense has had, are mental errors.
Loss of three on the play. Long count for Mayfield. They come after him with pressure, and he is sacked. Puna Ford again. Sophomore from Hilton Head, South Carolina.
Maintaining pass rush lanes. Understanding and keeping your eyes on the quarterback and not just running wild up the field. Excellent job by Puna Ford, staying disciplined in his pass rush.
Seibert on the punt again. Short kick and the fair catch made by Duke Thomas at the 23. They're without DeJay Johnson again, who would be their punt returner. Suffered a hand injury a week ago at TCU.
ESPN's College Football on ABC, brought to you by BMW. We only make one thing, the ultimate driving machine.
Back inside the Cotton Bowl, look inside the locker rooms. Charlie Strong has to be pleased with his defense so far. The Longhorns unranked, but in recent years that hasn't been a bad thing. The third straight year they've been unranked, taking on Oklahoma. Since 1989, Texas 5-2 when unranked and facing a ranked Oklahoma squad. On first down, Hurd handed the ball off, and a tough run for Jonathan Gray, who, despite the fine work of Deontay Foreman last week, who rushed for 112 yards against TCU, the coaches said this week, Jonathan Gray is still their number one option at running back.
I think you need two guys in today's day and age of football, Sean. The beating that these guys take in the up-tempo, it helps to have two.
Two receivers bunched to each side. Hurd takes it down and takes off running again. First down and out of bounds at the 35-yard line, a gain of eight.
You just feel confidence growing on that Texas sideline. You see Jay Norvell, and a good decision by Hurd. He had a four-seam route, four guys running deep. Nothing was there. Right away, tuck it and run and get positive yards. Good call by Jay Norvell. You start to see this offense get a little more comfortable under his play calling.
Norvell, a big part of the story for this game. The last 7 years, he was on the Oklahoma staff as co-offensive coordinator most recently. Hurd shows his running ability. Jay Norvell into his bag of tricks, and a 14-yard run. Consecutive first downs for Texas.
Well, it's interesting to see Hurd today able to run away from defenders, although it looks like he's struggling to get up right now, Sean.
It's a good call, though. That, I mean, that, he has to be part of their game plan for them to be successful and for them to be successful on the ground. They have two solid running backs, but really no threat to go the distance. Hurd provides that speed and breakaway threat running the football.
And I think a big thing to watch today, last week against TCU, he was not able to run away from that fast defense. Earlier in the season, Rice, Cal, Oklahoma State, he was. And it's almost like he got lulled into a false sense of security that anytime he doesn't see what he wants initially, he can take the ball and run away from defenders. Again, it wasn't the case last week. He's going to want to run today, but he needs to be faster with his eyes and decisions inside the pocket if Texas is going to win this game.
He took an awkward step toward the end of the run as he tried to dodge some traffic. And you wonder if that's where he hurt himself. You saw Tyrone Swoops warming up. He was the starter at the beginning of the year. The entire offense struggled in that 38-3 loss to open the year at Notre Dame. That's when Charlie Strong made the change, took the play calling duties away from Sean Watson, who was a co-offensive coordinator along with Joe Wickline, gave that task to Norvell and gave the quarterback job to Hurd. But Swoops has been involved primarily as a runner in short yardage situations. First and 10. Gray got stood up but still drove the pile back to the 45-yard line. Here's Cassidy Hubbard in the studio.
Thanks, Sean. Taco Bell studio update, and this play is not going to quiet any of the critics of the number one team. Perry Hillis to DJ Moore, 52-yard touchdown. Maryland up 7-0 early. This is the third time in the last four games Ohio State opponents have scored first. Sean?
Ohio State certainly has scuffled in some games this year in which you would not expect them to struggle. Jonathan Gray remains the running back. And a flip to Marcus Johnson, and he wants to throw it deep into double coverage. There's a flag down. The ball's intercepted by Zach Sanchez. Well, let's see what the flag is about. And Jay Norvell against his former team and former boss Bob Stoops digging into the bag of tricks early.
Holding by number 15 of the defense. It's a 15-yard penalty, and it's an automatic first down.
So it's a bad play by Sanchez, but a smart play. If you know you're going to get beat deep, go ahead and grab that guy. Makes a nice play in the ball, but you want to prevent six, so you go ahead and grab him because they did have it open there for a second. Ball was just underthrown by Marcus Johnson. I love what Texas is doing. Aggressive play calling, running inside, outside, and taking shots down the field.
Swoops, who started and played well against Oklahoma in this game last year, on target to John Burke for a short gain. Sanchez up to make the tackle. He'll mark it just inside the 33. Hurd back in the football game. To the 32-yard line, very little gain. Jordan Evans made the tackle. Third down and six.
If you're Oklahoma, one thing you have to be aware of is discipline in your pass rush lanes, because you know that if the Texas receivers are covered, even early on if they're covered, he does not have the patience to wait for them to come open. I believe he's told to tuck and run to try to get the first down with his legs.
Hurd was in the game for the completion a couple of plays ago. He takes off running and has the first down at the 24.
It's a good job by Jay Norvell. Again, attacking the edges. The defensive line for Oklahoma is going to all slant to the right. You see Stryker gets a little over-aggressive when he's supposed to be the contained player turning down. And now, if you want big plays, you want to have your guys do this. Block downfield, do not hold, hands inside. Excellent execution, and Texas is playing with a little bit of confidence, which they haven't had previously.
Important to score first as well. They're 0-10 under Charlie Strong, but they do not score first. Here's Johnson, the wide receiver. How about that fight? Touchdown!
is an excellent job of staying in bounds, but this is awful, awful by Oklahoma. We got two-hand touch there. We got two-hand touch there, and you score touchdowns. Last time I checked, you're allowed to tackle and put your shoulder pads on them instead of two-hand touch. Awful.
Marcus Johnson, the touchdown on a 24-yard run, the wide receiver out of League City, Texas. 77-yard drive, eight plays. A very rough week in Austin. Charlie Strong said a lot of the off-the-field issues were a little overblown, particularly the stuff about the underclassmen don't like the upperclassmen and that sort of thing. But it looked to us toward the end of last year, last week, Chris, at TCU, that the fight went out of them. That's clearly not the case. It is a very spirited performance by Texas so far today. Extra point good from Nick Rose. Texas leads 7-0.
Yeah, I love it when you get that beat. Boots on, stomp your feet. It's like you've been waiting on me.
We're back in the Cotton Bowl, the Red River rivalry. Texas scores first. 1-4, they had a couple of narrow defeats against Cal and Oklahoma State when the special teams let them down, but for the most part, they've been hammered this year, outgained coming in by 843 yards and outscored by 68 points. But impressive so far against the undefeated Sooners. There was a penalty on Marcus Johnson, who scored the touchdown for unsportsmanlike conduct. So Nick Rose is going to kick off from the 20. Alex Ross back deep. Oklahoma just 123rd in the country in kickoff return yardage. Bob Stoops looking for that to improve. And Ross lost the football as he hit the ground. Texas has it. And the question becomes, was he down before he lost the ball? The ruling on the field is a Texas recovery by Kirk Johnson.
When breaks are starting to go your way, if you're Texas, something they have not had as this season's gone on. Johnson comes in from the side. You have people hitting all over the place. Guys getting up, making plays. And last week we had a game of almost recovered this, almost didn't make that mistake. This week they are capitalizing on their opportunities to make plays as Johnson comes up with the recovery. Good job of stripping from behind and tackling the football.
Kevin Vaccaro in on the tackle. Question is, was his knee down before the ball came out?
I think it's on its way out.
Yep, it's starting on its way out. That call is going to stand. Doesn't look like the knee is down yet. But I think that's going to stand, Chris. Jim Blackwood is the replay official upstairs. And Cooper Castleberry waiting to hear what Jim has to say.
Deshaun Elliott, number four, also does a good job of reaching in there. Even though he's being blocked, tries to disengage. And watch his right arm kind of strip that ball
out.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
Excellent job. Not quitting on the play. And, Sean, this is a different Texas team. It's playing with confidence. And all along, Charlie would tell us on the phone or when we met with him, that we just need a few things to go our way, some good things to happen. And right now they are happening because the players are making it happen.
Well, they got some tough breaks early last week. DeJay Johnson injured early in that game. They had a bad snap on a punt that went for a safety, and it just spiraled out of control.
Ruling on the field stands. First down.
You see the emotion. I mean, with Charlie, it's just like all this frustration is coming out. Now, when you get this height, the one thing you have to remind yourself and your team, stay calm, stay focused. But you want to show that enthusiasm. And they're having fun. We haven't seen that for a Texas team in a long time.
Elliott is a young player who's really been impressing in practice. He's a safety. We're told he may see time as part of their defense today. Has not so far this season. 22 freshmen have played this year for Texas. It's a young team, including the redshirt freshman at quarterback, Jerod Hurd. Well, the Horns already leading 7-0. Hurd trouble with the high snap, and he got it back.
Again, this is Taylor Doyle, and kind of popped up there and threw a high one. Sometimes when you get emotional and you get jacked up, you got to stay with your fundamentals. You can see that his hand came up quick. Usually that hand is taught to go right at the quarterback's shins to deliver the perfect trajectory on the football. Another high one.
And after the fake, Hurd takes off running again. And goes down at the 22-yard line. Tackled by Hatari Bird. It's a 25-yard run for the Texas quarterback.
Really impressive play calling early on from Joe Wickline, the offensive coordinator. A lot of misdirection. The early theme is trying to get the ball out of Hurd's hands to the playmakers, and that time they fake the misdirection and give it to Hurd. I really think they're keeping Oklahoma right now, Chris, kind of on their heels.
Well, the other thing, too, is Joe, number 5, 2 key blocks. Key block on that long run. It also was the key blocker that sprung the touchdown.
Deontay Foreman off his career-high game against TCU last week. Tackled again by Hatari Bird. 6.5 minutes to go in the opening quarter.
Dominique Alexander's helmet came off, so he's leaving for a play.
That's why the clock stopped for a moment. And that's a big loss. He is the leading tackler for the Oklahoma defense. Foreman turns the corner, gets belted out of bounds, about a yard short of the first down. Tay Evans, who came in for Alexander, delivered a big hit. Redshirt freshman from Allen, Texas.
Well, Foreman had success last week, and he's earning carries, and he's a big guy that can run. And again, I'm going to go back to Joe. You don't have to be a receiver and always catch balls to play. You have to block like your life depends on it. And right now, number 5, Joe for the Longhorns, has done an outstanding job of sustaining blocks on the Oklahoma defensive backs.
Tyrone Swoops had come on the field to be the quarterback, as he has often this year in short yardage situations. 3rd and 1 for Texas when we come back. Texas and the Longhorns trying to take advantage of a turnover by Oklahoma. Fumbled on a kickoff return by Alex Ross. Big 3rd down and 1. And some last minute substitutions coming on the field, and now Oklahoma is going to have to use the timeout.
30-second time.
That shouldn't be the case. Why? Because Swoops is out there before the timeout. They know that Texas goes to Swoops in short yardage situations. You burn a timeout that you might need later in the half. But I understand the fact you want to get the right people. But that should be anticipated coming into that play.
Well, Chris, how about keys to victory today for Texas?
Well, I think so far they've answered all of them. They've handled any type of blitzes. Wide receivers not necessarily making plays with their hands, but making plays by blocking. So far, Puna Ford has been dominant on the inside pass rush. And instead of having special team errors, they're creating their own good fortune by causing fumble on the kickoff return. So far, it couldn't have gotten any better for that man right there and his Longhorns.
Huge play here. Texas trying to keep the momentum. Alex De La Torre in the game as a fullback. Design run for Swoops. He powers inside the 10 and goes down to the 7-yard line, perhaps even the 5. They're going to mark him down back at the 7. A 7-yard run. And they're going to keep Swoops in the game. He's busy celebrating. The coaches ran down, said, pay attention. They want to get quickly back to the line. Reminiscent of what Oklahoma's done in recent years with Blake Bell, the belldozer. Swoops, 244-pounder, chopped down inside the 5-yard line.
Same play, run it again until they stop it. And right now, I'm seeing Texas offensive linemen driving Sooner defensive linemen into the end zone.
Jordan Thomas, Ahmad Thomas on the tackle for Oklahoma. They stick with it. Why not? Touchdown Swoops. He was into the end zone before he lost the ball. check to make sure he had possession all the way across. Close, closer than it looked live for sure.
See?
Looks like he's breaking the plane there. With that ball starting to squirt out, that's going to be a very tough call.
The ruling on the field was a touchdown. The previous play is under further review.
Well, I think that's out, Sean. I think it is out right now. It has to be the plane starts at the front of the goal line, not the back of the goal line. And that's a heck of a job by Ahmad Temas fighting to strip that out. And to me, I don't think he crossed. Now, I don't know if that's overwhelming enough evidence to change it.
Thomas, 6 feet, 213 pounds, showing his strength. Tyrone Swoops is a load at 6'4", 244. He's not in yet. And question is the ball moving there? I think he might be right there, Chris. Yeah. I think the ball's coming away from his chest before he gets to the plane, as you said, the front part of that goal line. The most important part, of course, is the ruling on the field was a touchdown, so it needs to be conclusive to turn it over.
See that left hand punch it out. And it's a great effort by Thomas. Not only does he have 245-pound Swoops on him, but Patrick Vahey, who goes at 320, and he's knocking it out.
There's also the question about the recovery, because Stephen Parker didn't catch it. And Texas recovers the fumble in the corner of the end zone. Lorenzo Joe in the right spot.
He's been in the right spot the past few series, Lorenzo Joe.
But we were here last year. Texas, for long stretches of the game as a big underdog, outplayed Oklahoma.
After further review, ruling on the field is confirmed. Touchdown.
And they've certainly outplayed Oklahoma in the first 9 minutes plus here today.
Effort. That's what's getting it done right now. They want it. They're tired of being beaten up.
Nick Rose gone for the extra point. And Texas leads 14 to nothing. Just 41 yards in seven plays after the fumbled kickoff return. Tyrone Swoops had the final three runs. Shades of a couple of years ago, 2013 Red River rivalry game, Texas was unranked. Oklahoma ranked number 12. First quarter, Chris Whaley intercepted Blake Bell, returned it for a touchdown. Gave Texas a 10-3 lead. In the second quarter, Case McCoy to Marcus Johnson for 59 yards. It was 17-3. In the third quarter, Ajay Johnson, an 85-yard punt return for a touchdown. Mack Brown of Texas went on to upset Oklahoma 36-20. That would be Coach Brown's final Texas OU game.
They rivalry game, Sean. There's teams that always play with confidence. I know it's cliche that throw out the records in rivalry games, but it's so true because they know who they're playing and they know what it means to them and to the state.
Nick Rose picks off. This one's returnable for Alex Ross. Boy, took a hit, bounced off it, and staggered ahead for a yard or two.
Sean Elliott again playing it on him, making plays on special teams.
Oklahoma has not had a first down, minus one. The total offense for Baker Mayfield. Out of the pistol with Samaje Perine, the running back. One of the best running backs in the country. He goes up the middle. And on to the 32. Gain of 6 on first down. Tackled by Peter Jenkins, the leading tackler for the season for Texas, senior from Dallas.
Different look, going from 12 personnel, 2 tight ends to get the running game going.
And going very quickly. P. Ryan again. Got 2 more. It'll be 3rd down and 2. Nashawn Hughes the stop for Texas. Not much of a factor early on. P. Ryan lately, the last 2 games, averaging 108 per game against Tulsa and West Virginia. Averages 6 yards per carry for his career. Sophomore from Pflugerville, Texas, not far from Austin. Longhorn showing pressure. Mayfield dumps it in the flat. Nice one-handed catch by Dimitri Flowers. And he has the first Oklahoma first down of the game out to the 46-yard line. 12-yard pickup.
Watch his eyes, Sean. He's looking across the field, and a good setup by Oklahoma. Run, and a quick little play action off the run. Outstanding play call.
It's the 2nd catch of the year for Flowers. 4 wide receivers. Another blitz off the corner. P. Ryan forward for 2. Duke Thomas, the blitzing cornerback, helped blow up that play. Daniel Brooks, the running back to the right of Mayfield. Here comes Thomas on a blitz again. And it's a Texas sack. Back at the 42-yard line. Thomas has come up with the ball. Officials saying it was not a fumble.
Duke Thomas has been all over the field. It's been part of the game plan for Texas. They're showing him sometimes an inside linebacker. He's going to blitz up the middle. He's going to drop into coverage. Confusing looks. That time, really nice job timing the blitz off of the edge. You got to follow Duke Thomas and know where he is right now if you're Mayfield, the quarterback for the Sooners.
And the inside pressure, Todd, is forcing Mayfield to drop his eyes and take his eyes away from receivers down the field.
Timeout, Oklahoma.
30-second timeout.
It's the Texas team that has looked in disarray much of the season, but so far in this one, it's Oklahoma out of sorts. Tonight on ABC, in-state rivals clash. The Miami Hurricanes in Tallahassee to take on 12th-ranked Florida State. That's tonight at 8. 5 Pacific on ABC's Saturday Night Football, presented by Wells Fargo. Everett Golson, the Notre Dame transfer, has had a very nice start to his career in Florida State. And the Seminoles, a team a lot of people aren't paying much attention to. Still plenty of talent in Tallahassee.
Yeah, there is. They're going to be, unfortunately, if you're a Florida State fan, missing Delvon Cook with a hamstring injury, to find running back for the Seminoles.
3rd down and 14. 5 receivers spread the formation. Joe Mixon, a running back, has come in. He went in motion. Another blitz. Mayfield had to throw quickly, and it's incomplete. Broken up by Peter Jenkins. He had the coverage on Sterling Shepard.
The pressure is forcing Mayfield to dump off for checkdowns. Sterling Shepard is being handled right now by a linebacker, but the ball is late and behind because of the pressure by Thomas coming off the edge.
Seibert punts. Another fair catch made by Duke Thomas. 43-yard kick.
A lot of big plays right here, and long runs are always talked about from coaches about receivers blocking downfield. Good discipline, not grabbing any cloth. Lorenzo Joe doing his part. Again, you see Lorenzo Joe, hands inside and finishing, allowing the running game to get going, Todd.
Chris, it really has been impressive, especially from what we saw a week ago against TCU. Texas has just been the more physical team, whether it's in the trenches, the wide receivers blocking down the field, play a lot of confidence, but most importantly, they're just physical.
Well, I think when you get challenged and you get embarrassed, there's one or two choices that each individual makes on the football team. Either I'm going to compete or I'm going to fold up. And right now, Charlie Strong looks like he's got his Longhorns competing every single down, not just half the time, but all the time.
Each team down to one timeout remaining, 2:38 to go in the first quarter. Well, Chris, we were here last year. Texas outgained Oklahoma 482 to 232. They had 24 first downs to 11 for Oklahoma, but it was a couple of key plays, the kickoff return by Alex Ross. There was an interception return for a touchdown for Oklahoma. And we talked to Charlie Strong this week. He said, you know, it's not so much the other team that's beating us. We are making plays to hurt ourselves. They're not doing that so far today.
And so what he did was he showed his teams of all the mistakes that they were making, and hopefully they learned from them. And so far, that philosophy has worked by showing what you're doing wrong. And the players are responding because they have 11 guys making the plays and doing what they're supposed to do.
He said, there is a dissension within the ranks. These guys are practicing hard. They're playing hard. They've certainly come out hard today. Jonathan Gray, the ball carrier, he got 9. Hurd keeps it. And it's chased out by Zach Sanchez, but he got a first down.
You know, on our talk with Coach Stoops, Sean, he mentioned the fact that one thing he likes about his team is its mental toughness and its attitude. Well, they get a chance to show what their mental toughness is right now against their rival.
Hurd looked like he wanted to pass, didn't see anybody, pulled it down and ran for 2. Jordan Evans nearby, taking down to 1.5 minutes left in the first quarter. Hurd's already rushed for 61 yards, and his stand-in Swoops did a nice job down by the goal line. Another yard for Hurd, knocked down by Dominique Alexander. Here's Cassidy Hubbard.
All right, Sean, let's take a look at who's getting it done, presented by Wells Fargo. And Ohio State's been in the red zone twice so far today. Newsday T. Baird at QB both times. Baird got the first TD. Ezekiel Elliott scores here. Ohio State up 14-7 now in the second.
Get that offense going. Big question mark down there in Columbus.
Number one in the country, but certainly not a clear-cut number one. Unanimous number one to start the year. Approaching a half minute to go. There's Deontay Foreman again.
Very conservative play call. And I don't understand it. You have momentum. You get things going. You can always have them say, if that first read isn't there, tuck it and run. He's playing close to the vest. I think you have to play to win and play not to lose. There's a big difference in how you do that.
End of the first quarter. Much different looking Texas team than we saw just 1 week ago in Fort Worth. They outgained OU 133-15 and outscored them 14-0. John McDonough, Chris Spielman, Todd McShay back in Dallas on a beautiful October day. Texas 4-0, started the year ranked number 19 in the country. They've moved up to number 10. Last time they were ranked that low in the preseason was back in 2000, and that was a great year for the Sooners. Wound up winning the national championship. They've been outplayed through one quarter by their rival Texas today. Michael Dixon, the Australian, on the punt. Short, and it took a Texas bounce and goes out of bounds inside the 24-yard line. Here comes Baker Mayfield. Three drives, three punts, and they have the kickoff return fumble by Alex Ross. 3 yards rushing, 12 yards passing for Oklahoma. They've had trouble blocking. Mayfield pass is complete, and some good run after the catch by Deron Neal. Chased across the far boundary by Duke Thomas. Nine-yard gain, and Oklahoma comes up quickly. Just the second completion for Mayfield. John Bonney, the tackle on the Mayfield run at the 37-yard line.
John, on first and second down, you can read number 55, St. John, his stance. If it's parallel like it is on the left of your screen, that's run. If his shoulder's tilted and his right foot is back, it will help a defense, because then you can determine whether to tell your pass rush to get their pass rush on, or your defensive line to get their pass rush on, or play run.
Whistles and flags before the snap.
Just to go back to that, I mean, that's a film
study. False start by number 72 of the offense. It's a 5-yard penalty, and it's still first down.
The reason why his foot is back so he can get depth with his kick step to get himself in better position to pass pro. When that foot is up closer and almost even, he's doing that to fire out the football and run. So it helps your defensive lineman if they can get that read to play more aggressive with their pass rush if they can see it. It's a pass.
Mm-hmm. And it is a pass. A swing pass for Joe Mixon. Boy, they are fired up. Desmond Jackson in on the tackle and very animated as he came away from the stop and tried to keep his mates fired up.
I think they're just letting out their frustration, and coming into this ball game, you know, we felt that that defensive line for Texas certainly was a matchup that they could win against that offensive line from the Sooners, and so far they have.
Charlie Strong told us during the week, we have a good team. We need to keep believing that. They played like a good team so far. Malik Jefferson, the true freshman, highly touted recruit, is having a very solid freshman season in Austin.
They can't handle the pressure right now that Texas is bringing, whether it's five man, four man, six man. They have no answer, and that's a mistake by the offensive line of not sliding, Todd.
Yeah, the very good concept, too. Shiro Davis, number one, is their best edge rusher. You bring 46 Jefferson over there, and you make him choose, and Oklahoma did not have its protection set.
Third Texas sack. And Mayfield, you can see he is antsy, now just trying to get rid of it as fast as he can. And Mixon yanked down after a short gain, well short of the first down marker. Lincoln Riley, the offensive coordinator, told us Mayfield has done a great job. Obviously, the numbers bear that out. He's starting to emerge as a Heisman Trophy candidate. But he can be a little bit anxious in the pocket, and you can't blame him for being anxious. Today, he's had almost no time. Puna Ford is the injured player. Yeah, big part of that Texas front.
The reason why it is no time is that's taken away a major part of Oklahoma's offense, which is to jack the ball down the field to put stress on the defense. But the pressures that Vance Bedford has drawn up has been right on target, right on time. And the other thing, Sean, is that their inside defensive tackles, whether it's Jackson, Ridgeway, Puna Ford, they're getting a good push, so Mayfield has no passing lanes to turn into rushing lanes. That's how they're containing them.
The Texas defense that came in to this one giving up 38.2 points per game, 114th in the country. Seibert to punt. Duke Thomas. Fair catch. We'll mark it at the 24-yard line. Texas ball when we come back, a 43-yard punt. Here's today's Aflac trivia question.
Aflac.
I don't know which head coach on either team has the most wins in this Red River rivalry between Oklahoma and Texas. Charlie Strong looking for his first in his second year as Texas head coach. His team leads 14-0. Jonathan Gray stopped for a short loss on the play. That is the Texas part of the stands. But as you saw, a lot of crimson up there. Just a couple of days ago, there were thousands of the Texas tickets still available online, and there were a lot of empty seats in that part of the stadium when the game started. Gray again up the middle. P.L. Lindley made the tackle. Of course, there have been a lot of empty seats at the home games at Austin. We watched the tape of the Oklahoma State game. And it was apparent. You see again plenty of crimson in what should be a Texas section. In the upper reaches of the upper deck in the end zone to our left, there are a lot of empty seats. Very conservative series here right now for the Longhorns. Third down and 8. Look out. Hurd in trouble and just did throw it away.
Well, this is a bad read by Hurd. He has press coverage. His wide receiver to the single receiver side was going to run a slant go. But again, the pressure from Tapper, number 91, who needs to be a little bit more consistent in his play, forced Hurd to tuck it and not hit the slant go.
Sterling Shepard back for the punt from Michael Dixon. Very high end over end kick and a fair catch made. At the 29-yard line, 44-yard punt.
College football on ABC, brought to you by the Lincoln Motor Company and the entirely new Lincoln MKX. And Dr. Pepper. Dr. Pepper and college football, it's a one-of-a-kind tradition.
This annual Red River rivalry game, a big part of the State Fair of Texas. And for a healthy eater like Chris Spielman, yeah, this is not your favorite place to hang out. Deep fried Oreos, deep fried butter. I've never even heard of that before. Everything deep fried. You saw Texas turkey legs. I've played here since 1929. What a great venue.
Yeah, Big Tex. I went clubbing with Big Tex last night. It was fun.
I don't know who's less likely to go clubbing, a statue or you. Baker Mayfield on target and very near a first down. Dede Westbrook the catch.
You know, Sean, good design right there to get Mayfield out of the pocket because Oklahoma's offensive line cannot handle the inside pressure. So obviously what you do is move your quarterback and move the pocket so he has room and time to throw.
Holton Hill, the true freshman with the tackle, is good for a 10-yard gain. Daniel Brooks in at running back now. He got hit behind the line, surged forward for about a half yard.
And just to build on Chris's point, getting Mayfield out of the pockets one way. Another thing is some misdirection, just like we've seen from Texas, trying to take some pressure off of its offensive line. I think Oklahoma's got to work in some of that misdirection pre-snap with guys coming across the face of Mayfield. Got to get him some more time in order to exploit those mismatches they have with their wide receivers against the secondary of Texas.
You know, maybe Todd even get him involved in the running game because
yes,
he's certainly
point.
Capable. Called runs or zone reads.
Long time to get the play communicated. Mayfield time to get it off that time. And it's ruled a catch for Shepard, far sideline, and a first down at the 49.
Well, when you have pressure in your one-on-one coverage, you got to have a quarterback that could deliver the out. And that's perfect arm strength. It shows his accuracy on that out throw by reading the coverage of press.
First catch of the day for Shepard. averaging 5 per game starting today's game. Joe Mixon ran into Anthony Wheeler. Just across midfield now are the Sooners starting to get a little bit of rhythm on offense. Still run 21 plays now with just 52 yards of offense. And 22 of those 52 yards on this possession. Down 14-0. Mixon all kinds of running room. And another first down. He lowered his shoulder and ran over Holton Hill at the end of the run.
What a luxury, huh? You have P. Ryan coming in, running with power and anger. Then you bring young Mixon off the bench. He wants to fight for his carry, so he's going to run with power and anger.
Be the hitter rather than the hit E. I like it. Holton Hill, the tackle, we doubt he'll be tweeting about that at halftime, nor will any of the other Texas Longhorns. And he will put all the off-field distractions behind them today, and they're a big distraction to Mayfield. Their fourth sack. Bryce Cottrell leading the way.
Sean, take a look at the back foot. It's really back. That's going to tell him pass. So he's off on his horse, and Cottrell's going to come along. That puts a lot of pressure on him. And right there, when you run a nice little stunt and you beat him with speed, you got no shot. So maybe he needs to move that foot back a little further to get a bigger.
But number 24 of the defense. It's a 10-yard penalty, and it's first down.
Kick step. And both sets of offensive tackles. Orlando Brown on the other side, though, who's been solid, 6'9", and a lot of weight. Both of them are really good young players, but tackles fear speed more than anything off the edge.
Holding penalty on John Bonney, a big one, wipes out the sack, gives Oklahoma the first down at the 29-yard line. Daniel Brooks, they found something with that play action. He got popped, but has another first down. The speedy Brooks, state champion in Texas in high school in the 100 meters at 10-6.
That's a good job by Orlando Brown clearing that hole, pushing his man past the line of scrimmage to create space.
And a 14-yard gain. Mayfield off the fake to Brooks. Look at Mayfield battle down to the 5-yard line.
The versatile personnel is so important on both offense and defense. But here we've seen running back number 25, Joe Mixon. They've been splitting him out wide the last few plays. You have to account for him. They can then bring him into the backfield as well and go a two-back set. But that's been a big part of the success is the fact that they have a running back in Mixon that they can split out wide. And tell you one thing, for all the tape we watched, Chris, this week, and it was a lot.
Yeah,
that's all we did together was lift weights and watch tape.
Sounds like a honeymoon, doesn't it?
Wait a minute, what about clubbing with Big Tex?
That was last night.
I begged. Baker Mayfield, man, can't question his toughness. You saw that at the end of that run.
Well, and I think when you get him involved in a run, and it's all set up by having success with a zone read by running your running backs. You start running to those running backs as a defensive player, then you get Mayfield like this, fighting and gouging. And Sean, he's a leader. I mean, guys on this Oklahoma team follow this guy, whether he's dancing or playing Halo 3 or whatever he's doing. The one thing you get on the football field from him is tremendous effort.
Hassan Ridgeway, the injured player. We're into Vance Bedford, the defensive coordinator. He's their best defensive lineman, and that is the strength of the defense, clearly. They mark Mayfield down just short of the 5 and short of the first down. Second and 1. Mixon now lined up as a running back. Mayfield after the fake gets the first down. Pulled down by Jason Hall. And as Todd just said, no questioning the toughness of the Oklahoma quarterback. Listed at 6'1", 209, and both might be a little generous.
I like the versatility of that. Just getting him involved with the run, that's going to slow down the backside pursuit of the Longhorn defense.
They found a rhythm. They have 6 first downs on this drive. First and goal from the 4. Mixon tripped up. Bryce Cottrell, the junior from Plano here in the Dallas suburbs. Second and goal. Mayfield fired one, incomplete. Duke Thomas had the coverage on Sterling Shepard.
Well, Duke Thomas is a leader on this defense, and so you're going to go to your top guy, Shepard. Right there, Shepard has a beat inside, but he does a good job of cutting underneath, forcing a wide throw by Mayfield. You want to keep an eye right now on any type of quarterback run out of this. And also number 81, Mark Andrews, the tight end, 6'5", has three touchdowns on the rear, a lot of them in the red zone.
The Texas end of the field, deafening noise for Mayfield. He throws through the hands of his intended receiver, D.D. Westbrook. They had first and goal at the 4, now it's fourth and goal.
He's open. There's a tight window. And to me, you know, he's got to catch his ball. Working outside on the corner, he's got him beat, and the ball is delivered where he needs to snag that football.
It looked like he started to stumble a little bit there as the ball was arriving. So Seibert 7 for 7. No Oklahoma kicker has ever made the first 8 field goal attempts of his career. But Seibert has a 21-yarder to get Oklahoma on the board with 6:05 to go in the first half. Michael Honeycutt was the only kicker who had ever made his first 7 as a Sooner.
Affleck.
Now the answer to today's Affleck trivia question, we asked you which head coach has the most wins in the Red River rivalry.
Well, yes, I think it's probably Royalty in Austin, also my favorite baseball team, Darryl Royal.
I don't even know where to begin. First of all, I'm sure you cheated again this week, which is shocking. Man of your integrity, ethics, and morality.
Like I said, I was clubbing with Big Tech, so I'm acting a little strange today.
12 wins for Darryl Royal in this rivalry. Bob Stoops is alone in second with 10 and a chance for his 11th today. People who have coached at both schools, but Oklahoma, when you're the winningest coach in the history of the school, as Bob Stoops is, at a place where they've had Barry Switzer and Bud Wilkinson and Chuck Fairbanks. Wow.
Something about longevity and just staying the course.
Nick Hodgson, the kickoff. Chris Boyd won't try to run it out. Well, as so often the case, in rivalry games in particular, some wacky things happen. This is the second Texas touchdown. Here the Tyrone Swoops had scored from 3 yards out. The officials after the replay announced that the ruling on the field was confirmed, and the ruling was a touchdown for Swoops. The hands went in the air immediately. But the replay booth tells us they actually ruled that Joe should be credited with the touchdown in the corner of the end zone. And they've been trying to communicate that to the official scoring people. You can fumble the ball forward into your end zone if it's not fourth down. So we believe eventually Joe is going to be credited with the touchdown. Hard to believe in this day and age that the replay booth couldn't already communicate that to the official scorer, but we're told it will happen eventually. Marcus Johnson trying to find running room and could not. Ahmad Thomas. And now, boy, there are flags down behind the play, and there's an injured Oklahoma player down. It's Jordan Thomas and Armonte Foreman, a wide receiver. This was well away from the play, was walking away, but apparently a lot of people in the crowd saw whatever happened, as did the officials, because there are flags down right near where the injured player is on the field.
Yeah, those flags came flying from all different directions, and you know, we'll have to look at the replay to see what happened, but you want to play hard, you want to block downfield. You can see right here, Foreman just pushes him. I don't think that's egregious or
malicious in any way. He's blocking downfield.
Well, and if the play's over, it is.
Well, I don't know when
after
the whistle
the play,
was.
Unnecessary roughness by number 3 of Texas. Half the distance to the goal and replay first down. Correction, it's second down.
Well, the officials, as we just heard, ruling that it was after the play.
And he is their best cover guy. 2 interceptions last week.
Yeah, if you could hear
that's
the
late
whistles and good work by our crew, led by our producer, Bo Garrett, director, Mike Schwab, that was clearly way after the whistle. As Charlie Strong said, he told his team this week, that isn't necessarily what the other teams have been doing, it's what we've been doing to ourselves. Too many self-inflicted wounds throughout this season. On 2nd and 22, Jerod Hurd back to the line of scrimmage, and that's it. Matthew Romar in the middle of that defensive front. Charles Tapper.
See if they go after Marcus Green on this third down play, the replacement for Jordan Thomas. Redshirt freshman out of Cedar Hill, Texas, up here at the top of your screen.
Inside handoff to Deontay Foreman. It's nowhere near the first down marker, but does help tilt field position a little bit. Dominique Alexander ran him down. He's still 10 yards shy of the marker with a 12-yard pickup. So with under 5 minutes to go in the half, Bob Stoops and the Sooners will get the ball back, having scored on their last possession. Michael Dixon to punt. So far, everything's been clean on special teams today. It was a huge part of their losses against Cal when they missed an extra point late. Ooh, there's a blatant face mask as Shepard had his head yanked around. Chris Boyd, the young man who sent the tweet out from the locker room at halftime of the game last week at TCU, that touched off controversy. Never heard of anybody being on their phone at halftime of the game in a locker room.
A personal foul grabbing the face mask by number 2 of the kicking team. It's a 15-yard penalty in his first down.
Yeah, I think you got, you know, be careful of what you tweet or, in his case, retweet out. And coaches,
well, for those who didn't know, it was tweeted out by somebody that he should transfer to Texas A&M, and he retweeted that himself.
Stay off your phone. It's like I tell my kids. Get nothing accomplished with that.
Football action continues tonight on ESPN with a doubleheader at 7 Eastern, college football primetime presented by Hilton. Arkansas against number 8 Alabama, and then at 10, a battle of unbeatens, 23rd ranked Cal and number 5 Utah. All starts at 7 on ESPN, of course streaming live on Watch ESPN. Here it's 14-3, Texas leading Oklahoma. Oklahoma down 14-0, a field goal in their last possession. Start this possession in Texas territory, and Joe Mixon went forward for 3.
This is a big spot for Texas' defense. You play as well as you have the entire day, and all of a sudden, 4 minutes left, it's 14-3. You can't let this be a 4-point game going to halftime.
Rise up. It's your rival. Rise up. Hassan Ridgeway is back in the game, and here they come after Mayfield again.
Well, it's the story. It was the key to our game about inside pressure by the Longhorns. It's just winning simple one-on-one battles, and you have Boyette, number 93, beating 2. Beating the Texas center, Doyle. And the right guard, Cedric Flowers. When you have guys making plays and dominating up front like Texas, you're going to eliminate any downfield throwing by Baker Mayfield and the Sooners.
Officially the 4th. Texas sack. They had one wiped out by a defensive holding penalty. 3rd down and 12. 3.5 minutes to go in the half. Mayfield popped as he throws. And the ruling on the field is incomplete pass. Good effort along the far sideline by Antoine Davis.
Oh, this is beautiful, Sean. never losing sight and running the route for the receiver. He ran the route that Shepard was supposed to run. Shepard's got to do a better job of working back to that football. What a challenge.
Ibram on the punt. His fifth punt of the half. And what a beauty. As accurate as a Todd McShay pitching wedge marked down at the 3-yard line.
And it went out of bounds like his pitching wedge.
A look at our Pacific Life game summary.
Well, Texas has been able to establish things on the ground. Now, nothing thrown the football, but they've been taking advantage and making plays at opportune times as Jerron Hurd shows his speed and elusiveness. Four sacks for 20 yards. And it's all about the blitzing package that's been put together by Vance Bedford, and the inside pressure of the defensive tackles has been outstanding. And most importantly, their effort has been on cue.
After a 46-yard punt, Texas from its own 3-yard line. Just one timeout left for each team. Jonathan Gray across the five, and that's it. Jordan Evans and Dominique Alexander there for the stop. Ahead to the 11. It'll bring up a third down and two.
Gray wants the ball. He got a good lead block from his running mate back there, Foreman, with a two-back set at last play.
Like he got across the yellow line. The official running in from the far sideline. Looks like he has the first down. They're going to call on the chains, I believe.
It's a good initial surge by that offensive line of Texas.
And I would think, Chris, if it is a first down, Texas with just the one timeout left and leading by this much would play it conservatively here and just try to get into the locker room with the 11-point lead.
He's on that line. I would do that. I would, Sean. I mean, I think what you understand, you got 11-point lead, you're playing well. In the back of your mind, you know you've made a lot of mistakes. So just kind of stay conservative, run the football, force Oklahoma to use their timeout and get out.
That's the first down of the second quarter. And with the lead, Chris, the play calling more conservative, understandable with this field position and time score. But they had a lot more razzle-dazzle in the first quarter. Gray again. 16-yard line. Coming up at the half, stay tuned for John Saunders, Mark May, Mack Brown, and the Cooper Tires halftime report. Scores and highlights from all around college football. Gray again. Ooh. The official's got knocked down. Hope he's okay. Not getting up.
It's a tough spot to be in that umpire position. Winds up right by the linebackers. Again, it's just Texas guys finishing blocks. And I'm not going to blame a guy for finishing blocks. And you play two or through the whistle a half a second. That was Caleb Bullitt. Outstanding job of finishing blocks. And just thing. The official, without his back turned, didn't have a chance to defend himself.
Jim Adams, the umpire, back on his feet and a tough guy.
I love it. He's not coming out for a play. Good for him. That's a tough position to officiate. A lot of things happen, and they happen fast. So he got a little depth in his drop there right now.
Just five passes thrown in the half. Hurd's 3 for 3. Swoops 1 for 2. It pounded on the ground. Gray with his 6th straight carry on this possession. It'll be another first down, and you would think that would end the half. Snap it one more time. Actually, at the moment, yes, they'll have to snap it one more time. About 6 seconds difference between the game clock and the play clock. Gray again, and it's halftime. The Longhorns will head to the Twitter-free zone with an 11-point lead. And in pushing and shoving, David Blewett not content just to knock down officials, but some more of the Sooners before he got to the locker room. The Cooper Tires halftime report right after these messages.
Welcome to the Cooper Tires Halftime Report.
Well, sometimes it's better to be lucky than good. Texas was both in the first half as they get a touchdown here. 14-3 lead. Todd McShay is with Bob Stoops of Oklahoma.
Pass protection, a little bit of an issue in the first half. What do you do to get Baker Mayfield some more time?
Yeah, we've got to get guys open. They've got to run. We've got to get better route running, and he's got to get the ball out.
Defensively, couple series early on, you struggled, but you really seemed to make some adjustments and did a really good job. What do you have to continue to do on that side of the ball?
Yeah, the quarterback run game was a big issue early. We got it corrected to a point, got to keep doing it.
Okay, thanks, Coach.
All right, thank you very much, guys. John Saunders alongside of Mark May and Mac Brown. Mac, you've played in this game. Right, not played in the game. You've coached in this game.
Oh, I got played.
I bet, especially a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
You went with a big victory in that one.
Yes.
But as you watch this contest, you're not surprised at all that Texas has come out and played well.
No, the Texas players have a tremendous amount of pride. Charlie didn't like last week. He talked to those guys. They've had those team meetings and stirred things up. This is usually a game that the underdog feels less pressure and goes and relax and plays. And, Mark, the other thing about Texas, if you think about it, they've played well at home 3 times. They've really stunk on the road twice. So this is the first time I see them growing up a little bit here.
This is a team with a different attitude that we've seen before. This is a team that's not making the ridiculous mistakes on special teams. They're +1 in turnovers right now because of their special teams, and they're not making the mental mistakes on offense or defense. It's an entirely different football team this week compared to week past.
Don't forget, they've saved some of those critical errors for critical times in the game. So hopefully for Texas fans, they can hold on and play the way they have. 14-3 at halftime is good news for them. Elsewhere in the Big 12, of course, Baylor is at the top of the pack, undefeated, facing Kansas today. Should be a little walk in the park. Seth Russell, a little fake play, and then looks for Corey Coleman, has him for a touchdown.
Well, you see Seth Russell getting better every week, and he was the key to this team.
Russell and Coleman, they hooked up a few times in the first half. There's another touchdown, 14-7. And then a little play action this time, Mayday. He keeps it.
Outstanding job of blocking down the field. But Seth Russell's such a great athlete.
Shaq Linwood then makes a couple of moves here. He's going to run over one man, reach the end zone after it's reviewed. It's called a touchdown. They say stretch that out. And then the big man. Linwood taking it.
Pump,
Mark Manny for a touchdown. Mayday, would you have liked to? Did you ever do it?
No.
They never called his number. Joe Theismann wouldn't make that pass. Maryland facing Ohio State. And for the Buckeyes, Urban Meyer's waiting for his team to break out. JT Barrett, a quarterback, runs it up the middle. touchdown. Game's tied at 7. But then they know this one answer has worked all season. Ezekiel Elliott.
He does an outstanding job. Great push by the offensive line of Ohio State there. But if you're in trouble with this offense, hand it to him.
Cardale Jones in a quarterback now. Looking for the former quarterback, Braxton Miller, who makes a terrific catch. Just stretch it out. Now, that's an athlete there. And then Cardale Jones again. Touchdown to Braxton Miller.
Well, and I see both quarterbacks getting better now, and we've held them to a high standard, but, John, I think they're getting better each week.
Still a 21-14 game, very close. Illinois against Iowa, C.J. Beathard, Bobby's grandson, looking for George Kittle. He has a touchdown. They missed the extra point, though it's 6-0. Then Illinois, Keyshawn Vaughn fights his way in.
Different attitude by Illinois. This team's 4-1 coming into this game.
Beathard, a little screen pass to Jordan Kenziri. And he gets behind his block and goes for a touchdown.
And there are a lot of question marks about the Iowa team before the season. Kirk Ferentz has it rolling.
See, elsewhere in the Big Ten, Penn State in a little battle against Indiana. Remember, Indiana did give Ohio State quite a game, too. So Penn State up 19-7 at halftime there. This is a Cooper Tires halftime report. When we come back, we're going to start to make some picks. Get your pens and your pencils ready. We'll find out who the guys like this afternoon and later tonight. John Saunders alongside of Mac Brown and Mark May, and it is the time that folks have written in and said, please don't have these guys do that again. We're doing it anyway. They make their picks. And we don't remember how you did a week ago, though, so we hope folks at home are keeping track. Let's start off in the Big Ten. Northwestern against Michigan. Both teams surprised this year, and this game's going to separate which team's for real.
Both teams are led by defense. Statistically, they're the number one and number two scoring defenses in the country. But what separates these teams? The running attack of Northwestern, because they can get it done on the ground. They've got a great runner in Justin Jackson, over 125 yards a game. And quarterback Clayton Thorson is getting it done, running the ball and throwing the ball. But it's going to be defense that leads both teams, Coach.
Well, I think it's going to be a great football game, John and Mark. And I have to admit, when we used to pick bowl games, Sally would pick the winners better than me. So that really scares me as I start picking these against Mark. But I feel like you got to give Pat Fitzgerald so much credit, because he's come out and been gangbusters with this football team. They're playing with a lot of confidence, but they're going to Michigan. Michigan's got so much hype right now. Jim Harbaugh is getting done exactly what he wanted to get done at this time in the season, in preseason. They're throwing the ball better. They've done a tremendous job running the ball. I think Michigan wins this game because of their lines of scrimmage.
To the Big 12, Oklahoma State against West Virginia. Oklahoma State has a victory they probably shouldn't have against Texas, but they get the win. You know, they say good teams find a way to win. They've done that. Did they find a way to win against West Virginia?
Very quietly, Oklahoma State's undefeated in the Big 12, but Mason Rudolph, the quarterback, is doing a terrific job. Not only spreading the wealth around, but 8 consecutive games, 250 yards or more passing. He's going to get it done, but keep an eye on this defense for Oklahoma State. They're the best in the country at getting the quarterback, 22 sacks on the season. They're very balanced on both sides of the ball. I like Oklahoma State in this game.
I think this one's going to be a great game, too. We've got some really good games today, but I've been to Morgantown, West Virginia. You can't get there. You've been there, Mark.
Oh, yeah.
And when you get there, it's really, really hard to play. And those fans are going to be pumped.
They're nice.
So they are nice as long as they beat you really badly and they brag on you leaving. But they had chances to beat Oklahoma last week in Norman, and it just didn't work out for them. I think West Virginia finds a way to win against a very good and confident Oklahoma State team today.
Mark played at Pitt, so we're happy he escaped Morgantown, West Virginia.
Twice.
They don't
Twice.
Like the Panthers there as well. TCU against Kansas State. If you guys can't pick this one, well, then we have problems. I'm guessing TCU, the Horned Frogs, have that offense going. Their defense looked better a week ago.
They did, but offensively, this is a team that scored 50 points or more in 4 consecutive games. That's a TCU record, led by their quarterback coach, Trevon Boykin. I like TCU in this game.
Well, I like TCU too, but nobody likes going to Manhattan, Kansas, and trying to play or coach against a Bill Snyder football team. So Trevon Boykin wins this game, but it's going to be closer than anybody expects.
Was there any place you like to go?
No.
Like to go,
no,
coach?
No.
At home?
I like to go to Austin, Texas, because we did pretty good at home.
Still? No. Utah, meanwhile, Utah facing Cal. Now, Utah has been a team that people are now suddenly saying the Pac-12 may be the class.
Well, they're led by their offense, I think. And I like Utah in this game because of their quarterback, Travis Wilson, and Devontae Booker out of the backfield, not just running with the football, but also receiving the football out of the backfield.
Well, and you got to give Sonny Dykes credit. What a great year he's having right now. But I think that the Utah defense put so much pressure on Jared Goff, maybe the best pocket passer in the country, that it's hard for them to win on the road. Utah wins.
How good is the defense and how important is it in this game, and in a couple of teams that are capable offensively, especially Cal, traditionally good offensive team?
You know, we had Utah and Utah State on a Friday night, and it was a really, really good football game. But I'm telling you, Utah's defense is really good. What they're going to do with Jared Goff, they're going to stem up front. And then as he starts to roll, because Cal's going to have to move the pocket, and I talked to both these coaches, Jared Morris puts pressure, but he and Gianni Paul are downhill, and they put pressure on Vernon Adams and make him throw the ball away. Also, on long yardage situations, here's a second and eight. They're going to go man coverage and try to really lock Cal up, and then Jared Morris is going to blitz the quarterback, and he's going to try to get to Jared Goff. Now, Mark, tell us why Jared Goff's so good.
Because every NFL general manager is drooling over this player, because he can get it done right here under the barrel. The blitz come into his face. He'll step up in the pocket at 6'3", 214 pounds. He knows he's going to get hit with a football, but what does he do? He stays strong in the pocket and tall, completes a dime down the field to play. Terrific job. Here on another play, watch the safety turn assist, but watch off the play action pass. He's completing 71% of his passes off play action. But look at his vision down the field. He knows he's going to get tattooed here. He can feel the pressure of the rush. What does he do? Drops a beautiful pass over the safety for the touchdown. This is why the NFL can't wait to get his hands on him, because he's so cool under pressure. He makes plays. That's the biggest threat for this Utah defense is Jared Goff.
And this may come down to special teams, John, because both of these teams, Cal's got 18 takeaways. So it could be a better game than people think.
Special teams and don't go on the road.
Yeah.
Coaching.
Take your special teams and running game on the road if you have to go.
All right. These are the games, of course, that you can watch on ESPN or ABC later today, including our primetime game at 8 o'clock Eastern time, that old rivalry between Miami and Florida State. This is the Cooper Tires Halftime Report. Don't forget, you can stream and watch every game live at home or on the go. A couple of TV sets side by side. Just download the Watch ESPN app or visit WatchESPN.com. Now let's take a look at who you thought today's dependable performer was. Brought to you by Cooper Tires. An overwhelming number of you have Florida's freshman Will Greer as your dependable performer, as he had 66% of the votes. And Greer completed over 67% of his passes. Greer, the Gators will take on Missouri tonight at 7:30 Eastern time in Columbia. The Texas Longhorns with a 14-3 halftime lead. Second half after this message and a word from our ABC stations.
You're watching ESPN on ABC.
And we're back at the Cotton Bowl in Dallas, and time for today's State Farm halftime double check. And the thing that jumps out at me, Chris, 85 yards of total offense for Oklahoma. They came in averaging 522 per game, and it's as if they're having difficulty figuring out what they should even be trying to do. It looks like a big part of the problem is up front.
It is, and part of their offense coming in is throwing the ball down the field. Well, Baker Mayfield has no time to throw the ball down the field because of the pressure of the front four from Texas, and also Vance Bedford has dialed up some nice blitzes, and there's no adjustments being made to handle the pass pressure from Texas.
Mayfield, averaging 345 yards per game passing, had just 45 on 6 out of 12, completed only 3 balls to his wide receivers. And the other question I would have, Chris, is where's Samaje Perine, one of the leading rushers in the country last year? I know they've gone to more of a passing attack this year, but he had 4 carries in that first half for 14 yards.
Yeah, well, they went to the ground when they had their long drive, and they started mixing backs, but somebody's got to get the rhythm, whether it's Perine or Mixon, to establish some type of dominant force at the running back position.
Nick Hodgson, the kickoff. Chris Boyd, Got it out to the 29-yard line. Here's Todd McShay.
Very impressive early on from Texas in the running game. You saw the difference there, 138 for Texas versus 40 rush yards for Oklahoma. I thought creativity was a part of it, doing a really good job getting the receivers involved and then blocking downfield by the receivers. Lorenzo Joe really stands out as the one receiver that consistently did it well in the first half. Also, the zone read option, you see Deontay Foreman there. A lot of misdirection. They need to continue to do this and then take some shots, I think, down the field vertically, become a little bit more aggressive than they were late in that second half. First half.
It's a great point, Todd, because they got to throw the football to win this game. Eventually, they're going to have to put the ball in the air.
Jerod Hurd, the quarterback, hands it off. Jonathan Gray skipping through the hole and tumbling forward near a first down. Give him nine before Ahmad Thomas made the tackle.
Dominique Alexander's shoulders are turned. You can't play linebacker playing lateral. You have to be attacking downhill. Now watch his shoulders get parallel to the line of scrimmage. See how he's turned, Sean? You can't play that way. You have to be square to the line of scrimmage, and anytime you get that type of down block, you've got to be attacking the line of scrimmage, not playing lateral.
Third. Bobbled the snap, threw off the timing of the play, but Marcus Johnson has the first down. Chopped down after he crossed the 40-yard line by Stephen Parker.
Let's get some tackling or Oklahoma drills at Oklahoma because they're not tackling. Now Juan Sanchez is going to come into your pitcher, and he's going to come up and not wrap his arms. And on the touchdown run in the first half, we had two guys just throw their hands out there and not wrap up and come with any type of force. Oklahoma drill should be instilled.
Take the reverse action. Jerod Hurd got enough for the first down and then slid down in Oklahoma territory at the 45-yard line. Twelve-yard gain. Rushed for 73. He's thrown just six times for 36 yards. They've leaned heavily on the run. 33 runs to six passes. Jonathan Gray trying to plow forward. The lead block from the tight end Andrew Beck. And Jordan Evans made the tackle. Texas plays being called by Jay Norvell, who was on the Oklahoma staff and coached in seven of these games as a Sooner. Good pass. Hurd on target. Lorenzo Joe. The catch in the first down. Jay Norvell was relieved of his duties, as was his co-offensive coordinator and the play caller the last 2 years, Josh Heupel, at the end of last season. Jay Norvell said the big reason he came to Texas, he loves this Red River rivalry, the atmosphere here, and wanted to remain a part of it. Now he's on the south side of the Red River.
So far this game, he's called an excellent game.
One of the reasons they made the change to Norvell as the play caller after week one, when they made the quarterback change, Jay has the experience in this spread offense where Sean Watson, the previous play caller, was really a product of the West Coast offense.
Yeah, and they felt like Hurd could be a better operator with the spread as opposed to Swoops, who had some good games under Watson with the West Coast.
Interesting look here with the four receivers wide to the right. And Hurd throwing a deep single coverage on the left and incomplete, intended for Lorenzo Joe and well covered by Jordan Thomas.
And talking to Mike Stoops, the defensive coordinator for Oklahoma before the game, he said, you know, we really missed our cornerback number seven, Jordan Thomas. They feel like they have two good ones in Zach Sanchez and Thomas. And when Thomas was out a couple weeks ago against Tulsa, they gave up over 400 yards passing. He said, when I have both of these corners and can rely on them man-to-man like he does there, it also allows me to cheat some guys up and be a lot more creative with the blitz and versus the run.
Yeah, that's why we see Todd corners going in the first round that are good, because it gives you so much more versatility on defense.
Hurd in trouble, gets away, and has a first down to the 23-yard line.
Great players make great plays in great games. Charles Tapper has a chance to get his boys off the field. Cannot bring down the elusive Hurd, who's playing with abandon and toughness, and finds a way. There's no way he should be running through the arms of Charles Tapper, but he does to pick up the first to keep the sticks moving.
10-yard gain is sixth first down rushing. Jonathan Gray, the ball carrier. Matt Diamond, Jordan Wade, the tackle for Oklahoma. An impressive drive to begin the second half for the University of Texas.
Playing with confidence, playing angry, finishing blocks, out-efforting the Sooners.
Hurd to the 19-yard line.
So you have to anticipate, if you're Oklahoma, Sean, that Hurd's going to run the football. If they drop back to pass, if his first look is not there, then you have to have some type of presence in the middle of the field to take his throwing lanes and shut those down and not let him turn it into running lanes.
Eleventh play of the drive. Started at their own 29. Here's another first down on the catch by Marcus Johnson. Tackled immediately by Ahmad Thomas.
They've been waiting for Marcus Johnson to be a part of this offense. Does have explosive ability and just an outcut, and Thomas gets caught in man-to-man coverage looking back at the quarterback, and he'll pull away.
Jonathan Gray lowers his head and gets to the 10. Marcus Johnson had 5 catches all season entering today. He's had 4 today, and he had the touchdown on the run in the first half. 5 minutes taken off the clock by Texas.
Played well in last year's game. Touchdown last year.
Hurd picked his spot, got down to the 7. And another third down upcoming for Texas. Dominic Alexander made the tackle. He made his first career start 2 years ago in this Red River rivalry against Texas and had 19 tackles.
Well, what I would do is take Dominique and anybody else that's willing to bring pressure to take away all running lanes by the quarterback and make Hurd beat you through the air. Lock out man-to-man, and let's find out who's better.
Deontay Foreman in at running back. He's in trouble and pulled down for a big loss by P.L. Lindley.
Huge stop for the Sooners.
That brings on Nick Rose, the field goal kicker. Missed both attempts last week at TCU, just 4 out of 7 for the year. First attempt today from 27 yards. Ooh, he just did sneak it inside the left upright. The ball for more than 6.5 minutes and for 15 plays that added 3 points. If you're out and about on this college football Saturday, you don't have to miss any of the action while you're on the go. Stream any game live, download the Watch ESPN app, or go to watchespn.com. Well, there are obvious pockets of empty seats in the Texas part of the stands, but those Horns fans who are here are making plenty of noise. The lead back to 14, 17-3 after the field goal. Alex Ross straight ahead and chopped down at the 25-yard line. There is a flag down on the far sideline. Sean Elliott made the tackle.
Holding by number 36 of the receiving team. It's a 10-yard penalty and his first down.
Dimitri Flowers called for the hold. Here's today's AT&T strong performance.
Well, they have to slide protect. What they're not doing, as soon as P. Ryan goes across the formation, the whole offensive line has then to shift to the right a man. They don't. They stay left, which leaves an unblocked Malik Jefferson on the sack. Also, with speed rush, they handled okay. Farniok gets beat. Darlington, the center, is late on his help. Then you have Paul Boyette finishing off with the sack. Just miscommunication up front.
On first down, the first play of the second half on offense for Oklahoma. Samaje Perine got belted down by Hassan Ridgeway and Nashawn Hughes.
Just no movement, Sean, up front by that Oklahoma offensive line, which we noted was the weakness of this offense coming into this ball game.
86 yards of offense for OU. Baker Mayfield again under duress. Trying to do as much as he can on his own. He pays the price and lost the ball. He got laid out. The officials are marking it down.
Holt Hill and Malik Jefferson, two true freshmen coming in and playing. Holt Hill's going to come and good, put his head across the body.
Yeah, the ground caused the fumble.
Yeah. But what you're seeing here is the upperclassmen are starting to play with the lowerclassmen, and everybody finally on this defense is on the same page for Vance Bedford.
Third down and nine. They're 1 for 7 on third down. Blitz off the corner. It was picked up that time, and an open receiver and a first down. Deron Neal yanked back after he reached the 31-yard line. A huge third down conversion for the Sooners.
This is the perfect adjustment. Again, it's slide protection. This time they get it going the right way because you have P. Ryan coming over to pick up the on-block player. Great adjustment by the Oklahoma coaches at halftime on that.
Jason Hall in a safety blitz. Now Mayfield out of bounds at the 35. Taken out of bounds by Jason Hall. Mayfield's front was not. Walked on at Texas Tech. His dad inquired with the Texas coaches. He was told they had 5 scholarship quarterbacks already. Part of it was Mayfield's size. He's now 6'1", 209. He was 5'10 when he was in high school, late in his high school career. Sterling Shepard, the first down. And you're starting to see a little life come back to that Oklahoma sideline after an 8-yard gain.
And it's easy to run a good play when you only have 10 defenders out there. They had a defensive line substitute out with nobody substitute in. Good recognition by Mayfield to hit the quick screen. Mental error by the Longhorns.
Mayfield, time for a pump against the 4-man receiver and caught. Sterling Shepard deep into Texas territory.
We talked about it at halftime. Pass protection is everything from Oklahoma. From their perspective, when you look at their matchups on the perimeter and the quarterback that they have in Mayfield, if they can protect him, it's going to be, they're going to have the ability to throw the ball down the field.
After the 50-yard gain, Mayfield was able to spin away. What a battler he is down to the 2-yard line. Holden Hill made the tackle after Malik Jefferson whiffed. Oklahoma. Second and goal from the 2. Mayfield running out of time. Throws and it is caught. Dimitri Flowers, who looked like the intended target the entire way. He was covered for a while. Mayfield managed to zip it in there. And there are flags down on the play.
after the play. A personal foul by number 68 of the offense. It's a 15-yard penalty that will be enforced on the kickoff.
Jonathan Alvarez. So the touchdown stands. It's the first career touchdown for Dimitri Flowers, sophomore from San Antonio. And they're within a score. Seibert trying to make it a 7-point game. 87 yards and 8 plays. It's 17-10, Texas.
ESPN's College Football on ABC, brought to you by Dr. Pepper. Dr. Pepper and college football, it's a one-of-a-kind tradition. Nissan, premier partner of the Heisman Trophy. And Icy Hot Smart Relief TENS Therapy. Turn off pain.
Over to you, Chris. I'm getting dizzy just looking at these pictures for the State Fair of Texas, which dates back to 1886. More than 2.5 million people come to the State Fair every year and a part of it. The Texas-Oklahoma football game in front of 91,546 today.
Last year was my first time experiencing this game. It's a great rivalry. I mean, it's a lot of fun and the energy's awesome. College football, can't beat it.
87 yards on the touchdown drive for Oklahoma. 2 yards more than the Sooners had in the entire first half. Because of the penalty, the kickoff from the 20. Good catch by Chris Boyd to retreat and field it. Chris Boyd turns the corner. And is pulled down at the 44-yard line by the kicker, Nick Hodgson.
I love the call. You get a little play action here on the goal line. You got Andrews coming to the flag. Yeah, Flowers releasing into the flat. But the patience of Mayfield allows this play to work.
That's what really stood out to me, Chris. When you study his eyes from the end zone, as I was, he wanted to go right away. He wasn't open. Then he looks back to Andrews, not open again. And when you're getting strung out that far to the sideline, you start to get a little anxious, but he doesn't, shows patience and drills it right where it has to go.
Dimitri Flowers sitting down and not running out of bounds.
Play action pass on first down for Gerard Hurd. Wanted to throw a deep one and ran out of time. Eric Stryker and Dominique Alexander, two of the big playmakers for the Oklahoma defense.
Well, Mike Stoops will not be deterred. He's going to continue to bring pressure. And why not with Eric Stryker? Maybe one of the best outside rushers in the game with a nice quick rip, then the ability to close with speed.
First sack of the day for Oklahoma. The Sooners had 7 last week against West Virginia. Deontay Foreman got bounced around, still managed to reach the 43-yard line. Stryker involved in the stop again with Charles Tapper. Third down and 11 for Texas.
I'm Oklahoma. I'm looking to take out number 7, Marcus Johnson. Seems to be the most dangerous receiver on the field for the Longhorns since DeJay Johnson is out.
6 for 11 on third down today. They started the day 30% for the year. There's Mike Stoops, defensive coordinator. 4-man rush. Hurd shovels it forward. It's caught for a very short gain by John Burt. Zach Sanchez there for Oklahoma.
He was looking downfield for Marcus Johnson on the post, but he made the good decisions because Atari Burt came over from the safety position opposite the field and helped on the post, and that was a good decision by Hurd just to dump the check down.
Michael Dixon, the punter. And a fair catch made by Sterling Shepard. 37-yard punt. Feels like momentum has shifted toward the Oklahoma Sooners. Down by a touchdown as they get the ball back. Celebrating its 11th year, sponsoring the Good Hands Field Goal Nets. Allstate makes contributions to participating universities, general scholarship funds, For each field goal and extra point kick to date, Allstate has contributed millions in scholarship funds. First and 10, Oklahoma. Down by 7. Baker Mayfield, complete. Jarvis Baxter has a first down to the 31-yard line, a gain of 13 for the junior from Garland, Texas.
Sean, you get the feeling that this is where Texas can prove itself. Are they over the hump? Are they going to have that mental toughness that they've been looking for all year? Not going to tank if things go bad or momentum shifts.
Baker Mayfield is 5 for 5 in this half. Joe Mixon found a hole up the middle and got 8 more. Mayfield on the roll, caught. Sterling Shepard into Texas territory.
Really impressive job by Mayfield there. He had a defender in his face rolling out, made the quick decision and the quick release to get the ball out in time. Nice throw.
Working in tandem with Sterling Shepard, working back toward the football.
If you're Texas, wouldn't you keep bringing the pressure on defense? You were successful with it in the first half.
I think that you have to go to that. Absolutely.
Mixon just across the line of scrimmage, and that's all.
The problem they're having, if you're Texas, they're also starting to, and it could worry a defensive coordinator, they're establishing a little something on the ground, which makes the defensive coordinator start to guess. Then they start throwing the ball. So they're having a little success kind of establishing some type of balance on their offense, which they didn't have in the first half.
Texas showing blitz. Mayfield looking to the sideline for some guidance. Still 10 on the play clock. A minute and a half to go, third quarter. Play broken up by Duke Thomas, intended for Sterling Shepard. This week on Monday Night Football on ESPN, the Steelers take on Phillip Rivers and the San Diego Chargers. That's at 8:15 Eastern on ESPN. Also live on Watch ESPN. Coverage starting at 6 with Monday Night Countdown served by Applebee's.
Let's see if Oklahoma can handle any type of pressure, whether it's 4, 5, or 6-man pressure, as long as they get their communication.
They were aggressive on defense in the first half and caused Oklahoma all kinds of problems. Very tentative 4-man rush. They don't want Mayfield to take off running. There's a flag down in the offensive backfield. Mayfield, a little stutter step to get a couple of extra yards. Duke Thomas made the tackle. He's well short of the first down, so this is a hold or hands to the face against Oklahoma. Charlie Strong will have a decision to make.
A personal foul, hands to the face, number 78 of the offense. It's a 15-yard penalty and replay third down.
Orlando Brown, the left tackle. That Orlando played with distinction in the NFL.
See Bryce Cottrell working one-on-one. Sometimes when you're 6'9", it's tough to get low. See if he took his hands off the face mask after he went there, but that's an immediate penalty once it happens.
They turn down the penalty. So it's 4th down and 8 at the Texas 47. We're inclined to run a fake. This isn't the worst field position to do it in. Well, 8 yards is a significant amount of ground to make, and they do kick it. So again, another good punt. That went out at the 3 in the first half. They'll mark this one at the 11-yard line. 36-yard punt. College football action continues today here on ABC, 3:30 Eastern Time. Georgia Tech in Death Valley to take on sixth-ranked Clemson. Some of you will see Wisconsin and Nebraska. Both games available nationally on either ABC or ESPN2. So if you're looking for one of them, don't find it. Try the other carrier, either ABC or ESPN2. Of course, streaming live on Watch ESPN. Check your local listings. That Georgia Tech team has gone into a tailspin, and Clemson's won 32 in a row against unranked teams.
Dangerous team for Clemson to play, though, even after coming off that big win against Notre Dame.
Texas from its own 11. Deontay Foreman dropped for a loss. Derek Stryker much more of a presence here in the second half than he was in the first.
Well, they're bringing him inside and having him put his ears back and go because it brought Stephen Parker on a blitz. So that way Stryker has no worries about the ball getting outside of him because Stephen Parker will handle that. Number 10.
Under a half minute to go in the third quarter. Texas trying to pull off a big upset. Deontay Foreman rumbling free. Deontay Foreman across midfield. Inside the 20, Zach Sanchez knocks him out of bounds.
Well, 241 pounds. This man could run, and it's all set up by outstanding blocking right there, caving in the corner of Jordan Evans that missed tackles again. Nobody wrapping up and just diving at people's feet. You see the big fella just ran out of gas as Sanchez came off the finish. But outstanding job of execution by the offensive line of the Longhorns.
An 81-yard run by the sophomore from Texas City, Texas.
And we noticed last week against TCU, well, there's no question Jonathan Gray is a senior, 5'10", 211 pounds, and runs hard. He's their leader, and they want him on the field, really good in pass protection. But there's a big difference when Foreman gets the ball. He just, even at 241 pounds, has a little bit more juice in his legs, and he's able to outrun defenders a little bit more.
Well, I think as the season goes on, Sean, because he keeps, or Antoine, that he keeps performing, you got to get him the football. I mean, he's a guy that will get stronger as the game goes. He's 240 pounds, and let him pound on defenses.
Well, I think you made the point. 241 pounds running away for much of that run from defensive backs until he did appear to run out of steam near the end. By far the longest play of the year for Texas. Previous long was a 69-yard pass play. The longest run prior to today was 45 yards. And it's going to end the third quarter. They started the clock at the field. Charlie Strong says, we don't need a signature win. We just need a win. But a win over their arch rival would do a world of good for Texas football. We welcome you back to the Red River Rivalry from the Cotton Bowl in Dallas. Sean McDonough, Chris Spielman, and Todd McShay. A glorious day in Dallas, Texas. And a surprise, perhaps, in the making. Texas limped in at 1-4. Oklahoma 4-0, but it's the Longhorns leading 17-10 as we go to the fourth quarter. Tyrone Swoops had come in, the backup quarterback. And Oklahoma has used a timeout.
That's the second time they had to take. I think that you have a defense plan. It's not a secret that Tyrone Swoops comes in to pound the football.
Atari Bird apparently on the field when he should not have been. Oklahoma uses a timeout. Be very costly down the road. Texas in the red zone after an 81-yard run by Deontay Foreman, the 11th longest run in Texas football history.
Last time they used Swoop, Sean, three straight runs. Don't be surprised if they have a little play action off of that.
Starter last year in their near miss against Oklahoma. And he played well last year. We mentioned the statistical edge was major for the Longhorns. Swoops threw for a career-high 334 last year against Oklahoma. He certainly can throw it. passed for two touchdowns, ran for a touchdown with 50 yards. He comes off the field now. Jerod Hurd, the starter, back in. And Texas with the lead by seven and poised to take a two-score lead, not in any hurry to snap the ball. Hurd, after the fake, gets to the corner and is out of bounds at the two-yard line. Bob Stoops glad that Hatari Bird was on the field on that play because he saved the touchdown.
Well, and you can see just the explosiveness of Hurd and great effort by Hatari Bird of forcing him out at the two-yard line. Outstanding effort. That's personnel matchups, and here comes Swoops back into the ball game with Wildcat. And I'm telling you, if you have a play-action pass off of this formation, now would be the time to run it, although they've had great success running it.
Swoops in. Alex Della Torre, the fullback, on his left hip. There it is. Wide open, as you said, Chris Spielman. Touchdown, Caleb Blewett.
You know it's coming, right? And Blewett's going to sneak out here, act like he's blocking. Good sell and patience by Swoops. Not panicking, not hurrying to throw, and delivering a very catchable ball to Blewett. It was dealer's choice. He had one or two. And that Oklahoma had to sell out for the run.
Nick Rose for the extra point. Good hold by Trey Holtz. Swoops. Give him a lot of credit. He lost his starting job, but he has remained a very important member of this Texas football program. After the Cal-Utah game tonight, the two unbeatens, don't miss SportsCenter at night on ESPN. All of today's college football highlights, action for the Major League Baseball playoffs. SportsCenter at night right after Cal-Utah on ESPN, streaming live on Watch ESPN. They're very excited here in the Metroplex over the success of the Texas Rangers so far in their series with the Blue Jays. Nick Rose's kickoff is a touchback. Here's today's Good Hands play, brought to you by Allstate and Todd McShay.
A really nice job by Texas, I think, using Eric Stryker's aggressiveness against him. Stryker's one of the best pass rushers in the country. He gets up the field, does a really nice job usually. But how about Jay Norvell, the play caller, coordinator for Texas, thinking about that play in advance, knowing the right time to use it, and then Hurd with the good read. Comes down to Deontay Foreman, just taillights on that run. Great job of play calling by Norvell.
Hey, and if you're Texas here, and Sean, you made a great point about keep bringing pressure. If you do, you do it with zone pressure and make sure the ball never goes over the top and to keep it in front of you for the Longhorn defense.
The first career touchdown for Caleb Blewett. It's back to a 14-point lead for Texas. Joe Mixon took the quick pass and got seven to the 32-yard line, tackled by Paul Boyette. Baker Mayfield is 7 for 8 passing in the second half. Facing much less pressure from the Texas rush. On target again, Jarvis Baxter got walloped, but also got a first down. Devontae Davis, another one of those true freshmen, seeing a lot of playing time for UT. Thomas there as well. He's had a good day. Good move by Mayfield. He was going to go down, so get two or three more. With Nayshon Hughes nearby, the play goes to the 41.
And then good decisions. The thing I like about Baker Mayfield, a little different from Knight last year, his number one priority is to protect the football, both run and pass, and not force it in there when it's not there.
He came in having thrown at least 3 touchdown passes in each of their first 4 games. 13 total in 4 games. Slant, caught, Another first down. D.D. Westbrook out near midfield. They'll spot him at the 48.
Well, there's 12:37 remaining in this game, and we watched the tape this week of the Tennessee game for Oklahoma. Mayfield's been in this situation before. Obviously, the clock's working against him, but he will handle it with a lot of poise if that Tennessee game's any indication.
They were down 17-0 on the road in Knoxville and rallied the win in double overtime. Samaje Perine stacked up at the line of scrimmage. Malik Jefferson helped finish him off. Peter Jenkins, the primary tackler.
Outstanding job by Peter Jenkins. I would say, Sean, out of all the guys on this Texas team, out of all the talkers, he's the one you listen to. He's the leader, and you cannot lead if you don't produce. Well, he produces, so he can lead.
Fourth-year senior, backup most of his career. That was just the second carry for Samaje Perine since the first quarter. Basically in the witness protection program today. Mayfield dropped for a loss. Paul Boyette, another stop, the junior from Humble, Texas.
Discipline on a defense, something that's been lacking right here. And Boyette's going to come off of his double team. 93, defeating his blocker one-on-one. What looked like a hole closed down by Boyette.
Enormous third down and 11. Will Texas come after Mayfield? Doesn't look like they will. It's a run with Perine. Good call and a first down. Third and 11, they go to Perine out of the witness protection program and into Texas territory at the 39-yard line.
And that's a great check by Mayfield. I believe he audible to that, seeing what he liked on the defensive side.
15-yard gain, the inside fake to Perine, the throw to D.D. Westbrook. He's collared after a short game. Plenty of time left for Oklahoma, almost 11 minutes remaining. Down 24-10, they trail 14-0. Texas, in the first quarter,
Texas can bring in fresh bodies, Sean. They have depth at that defensive line, and that's such a benefit, especially when an up-tempo drive.
A young Texas team in a lot of places, but that is a veteran and very good defensive front four. Mayfield under duress. Lost it downfield, incomplete, and a heavy collision along the near sideline. Duke Thomas again plastered Daniel Brooks.
These cornerbacks are doing a really nice job. And Thomas, we talked about all day long. He's not able to get there in time to play the ball, but he knows he has to play the receiver, and he does it at the perfect time, getting there right in time, timing it up. It's so important for these defensive backs when you're not in position to play the ball.
And Todd, they're doing a great job with eye discipline, understanding that they're playing deep to short, not short to deep, keeping the ball in front of them, not jumping anything at that corner spot.
Third and 8, might be four down territory. They just converted third and 11. Push up the middle with a four-man rush, and Mayfield only able to get back to the line of scrimmage. Desmond Jackson the stop. And Bob Stoops with the decision to make, the offense staying on the field as the clock runs under 10 minutes to go in this Red River rivalry game.
He has to look for Shepard. I mean, that's the go-to guy. That's the veteran. You see Duke Thomas lined up on Shepard right there.
Four-man rush. Time this time for Mayfield. Running out of time. Running for his life and for the boundary and for a first down.
Coverage downfield is outstanding, but what you have is a quarterback that does not panic. Sees a hole and takes it.
Needed 8, got 9. Samaje Perine to the 25-yard line. Gain of 3.
I think the most impressive part of that conversion by Mayfield is the fact that he was looking, as you mentioned prior to the snap, for Sterling Shepard, his go-to receiver. Shepard fell down. They were bracketing him, but he fell down. And at that point, a lot of quarterbacks would have panicked. Mayfield didn't at all.
Great knowledge of the offense. He knows where the weakness is and is patient in the pocket.
And just a four-man rush. They put pressure on, but plenty of time for Mayfield. And down to the two-yard line goes Micaiah Quick, his first catch of the day. Holton Hill made the tackle. 23 yards, first and goal for Oklahoma.
You give him protection. You allow him to come off of his first read and let routes develop downfield. And Quick finds the hole in the zone and sits it down to the open spot. And the ball is delivered there in a hurry and on target.
Fourteenth play of the drive. Perine delivers the hit. He plowed his way down to the one. Heavy collision with Peter Jenkins. They get up quickly. Perine again to the goal line. No signal of a touchdown yet. The Sooner fans think they have it, and now they do.
Second effort by P. Ryan. Driving those legs, understanding the importance of fighting for every inch in this ball game, succeeds.
Plays under further review.
It took nearly 6 minutes, but it ended in at least 6 points for Oklahoma, pending the review. And with 8 minutes to go, more work for Charlie Strong and the Longhorns to do if they're going to pull off this major upset.
I think he's definitely in right here. Those legs never stop. That's an easy touchdown. But you know what I've been impressed with, and they have to do it again, Sean. They have to answer the challenge. Texas has been up for every challenge. Any adversity that they faced today, they've answered it.
And again, I don't want to belabor the point, but in the first half, Texas was very aggressive on defense. Oklahoma had under 100 yards of offense. They're getting push and pressure, as we saw on that drive with four.
Yeah.
But they're not disrupting Mayfield or the offense anywhere near like what they did. I mean, on a couple of those plays, couldn't you be more aggressive?
You think so, but on third downs, you know, that's been the killer, right? They had them in third and 11, which they were pretty aggressive. Texas converted.
After further review, the ruling on the field stands. Touchdown.
Third and 8, they converted, and that's been their Achilles heel on the defensive side of the ball.
One of the worst in the country. 52.6% of the time the opponents have converted against Texas on third down entering today. 122nd in the country out of 127. Austin Seibert, the true freshman, makes it a 7-point game. 8 minutes to go in the Red River rivalry.
ESPN's College Football on ABC, brought to you by Pacific Life. For life insurance, annuities, and investments, choose Pacific Life, the power to help you succeed. And Buick, proud partner of the NCAA.
Oklahoma back within a touchdown with 8 minutes to go. Texas leading by 7, 24-17. The Longhorns, a 16.5-point underdog entering today's game. Nick Hodgson to kick off. Chris Boyd is the deep man for Texas. PJ Locke retreated to catch the ball and take a knee.
Chris, it's real easy when you're a quarterback and you're down by two touchdowns in the fourth quarter to start pressing. We have not seen that from Baker Mayfield. Doing a really good job hanging in the pocket, waiting for his routes to develop, and then if nothing's there, taking off and running. We've seen the toughness, the agility, the passing skill when he is able to find an open receiver. He was the difference in that long drive for Oklahoma, and they needed that scoring touchdown to bring it within one score.
Now let's just not discount the offensive line play by the Sooners that have given him protection to be able to hang in that pocket and make good decisions.
On first down, they fake the reverse. Jerod Hurd reversing his field and goes out of bounds with a first down just across the 35. Here's Cassidy Hubbard.
An update from Columbus, Sean. The Buckeyes are 3-for-3 in the red zone with JT Barrett at quarterback. Barrett gets his second TD of the day. Ohio State up 35-21 in the fourth. Sean.
Again, closer than expected for the Buckeyes. But they keep on winning. Donovan Gray knocked down from behind. Bounced forward for two in the arms of Stephen Parker. 7.5 minutes to go, midway through the fourth quarter.
You know, that was the same play. The Foreman ran for 81 yards. This time the difference was Stryker was not out there by himself. Parker came on a blitz to cut down any cutback.
Texas has run the ball 49 times. They've thrown just 11 passes. They've rushed for 277. The rare throw today for Hurd. Couldn't find anywhere to go with it. And is dropped for a loss by Stryker. Back at the 34-yard line.
This good coverage downfield. Stryker staying in his coverage, then understanding on scramble drill, he's second contained. Nothing gets outside of him, and like he often does, finishes.
Second sack of the day for Eric Stryker, 20 for his career, most all-time among Oklahoma linebackers.
So you have one-on-one coverage on the outside, expect blitz and try to hit an outside receiver.
They do blitz, and Hurd had to get rid of it. Zach Sanchez came on a corner blitz and totally destroyed the play.
Well, we can see it from up here. And this is the MO of Mike Stoops. He's got you on the ropes. He's going to bring Zach Sanchez on the corner blitz, having his eyes forced. Safety will come over and cover down any type of receiver in that area. See Zach Sanchez times it perfectly. The offensive tackle has no shot, and a good decision by Hurd to get rid of it.
They are playing again today without Kent Perkins. They're starting right offensive tackle. Michael Dixon, a good punt. Oklahoma trying to run that fake where they draw the coverage team to one side of the field. Then the ball's retrieved on the other by Micaiah Quick. But Texas, well disciplined, made the tackle at the 20-yard line. Here's a look at this week's Associated Press College Football Rankings, brought to you by Goodyear. Chris Spielman's Ohio State Buckeyes going to get another win, it appears, Chris. Unanimous number one starting the year, but certainly opening the door for these other teams behind them if somebody can make an impressive statement.
Yeah, they haven't put together an offensive and defensive game yet. The offense seems to be clicking today, but the defense is struggling a little bit.
Oklahoma ball. Twice they've trailed by 14. They marched down the field on their last drive. Baker Mayfield now 12 out of 14 in this half. As he threw a short one to D.D. Westbrook, who's out of bounds at the 26-yard line, bounced out by Devontae Davis.
And guys, one of the big differences in that last drive, Hassan Ridgeway, number 98, the big sophomore, he was not on the field. He actually is done for the day with a left shoulder injury. So the best player on that defense for Texas no longer on the field for them today.
That's even more reason to bring some pressure. Again, a four-man rush, and again, Mayfield picks it apart. First down to Sterling Shepard.
But here's a reason why you're not going to bring pressure and a reason why you shouldn't bring pressure. The reason why not is because Oklahoma can throw the ball deep and they can tie this game in a hurry, and you don't have confidence in your freshman corners to put them out on an island. The reason two, you bring five, but you play zone behind it. That's how you can generate some type of pressure. Here comes five right now.
And they get after Mayfield and drop him back at the 30-yard line. Malik Jefferson first there.
Well, exactly. They got tired of it, Sean, and here it comes. They're going to bring five right here. These three guys, that's five. And Oklahoma has had trouble in the first half picking up these stunts. And P. Ryan misses, does not see the backer come late, and doesn't get over there in time to help.
Fifth sack by Texas. Second and 18, 5 minutes to go. Pressure again, short throw caught by Shepard. Holton Hill, one of those freshmen there immediately. 34-yard line, the spot. They need 14 on third down.
And they're playing zone with it, so that time Shepard had a little out route, and he ran right into the corner, Holton Hill, but you still brought five.
And the pressure forced a quick and short throw. 4.5 minutes to go. Bear in mind, Oklahoma used a timeout on defense. Now Texas will use a timeout with 4:24 to go. Looking for the biggest win by far with the two-year Charlie Strong, Aaron, leading by 7. Many of the fans in the Cotton Bowl on their feet. Another huge play for the Oklahoma offense. They marched down the field to make it a 1-touchdown game on their last drive, converting a 3rd and 11 and a 4th and 8 along the way. Now it's 3rd and 14 from their own 34. How will Texas play it after Charlie Strong used a timeout? Baker Mayfield is 14 for 16 in the second half. Four-man rush, but pressure in his face. And down he goes. Back inside the 20. Puna Ford, Nashawn Hughes, an enormous play for Texas.
They're actually going to bring, drop one out late, Sean, to spy Baker Mayfield, because Baker Mayfield converted 2 previous third downs with his feet. There's 3 guys coming, and you see again, Nashawn Hughes beats Zeus Orlando Brown outside. Brown pushes him out, and Baker Mayfield runs right out into the pressure, allowing Nashawn Hughes to get the sack.
And now a flag for a false start. The sack. It was a 17-yard loss for Oklahoma. The penalty will be 5 more.
Number 19 of the offense. It's a 5-yard penalty, and it's still 4th down.
Puna Ford will come in and clean up, and that was with a 3-man pressure, but disguised very well.
On 4th and 36. Luke Thomas instructing his teammates to get away from Austin Seibert's punt, which bounces out of bounds inside the 45-yard line. 32-yard punt.
Charlie Strong's going to find out if his team can finish.
Well, Alabama had that huge win last week at Georgia. Doesn't want to have a letdown against Arkansas. They've beaten the Hogs in the last 8 meetings. That gets us started on ESPN tonight at 7 Eastern time. And then one of the big games of the weekend, the 2 remaining undefeated teams in the Pac-12. Who would have thought that when the season started? They'd be Cal and Utah. That's at 10 o'clock tonight on ESPN.
Kyle Whittingham, he keeps getting it on, doesn't he? He's an incredible coach.
3:33 to go, 2 timeouts for Oklahoma. As you would expect, a run. Jonathan Gray inside the 30. Tackled from behind by Jordan Evans. And that puts them into field goal range at the very least with a 15-yard run.
Jay Norvell coaches wide receivers. Now, they're not catching a lot of passes, but they're winning this ball game by finishing downfield and doing it with discipline and not grabbing and holding on to jerseys. Now, I run this clock down, Sean. I don't snap this ball until there's 3 seconds left on that shot clock.
You're right, and they're going way too fast if they snap it anytime soon. Rod Hurd, a redshirt freshman quarterback, is taking a look at the clock. Snaps it with 5. 3 minutes to go. Gray wants to make sure he hangs onto the ball. Stephen Parker trying to strip it. Oklahoma timeout. For that one they had to use earlier because they had the wrong personnel on the field on defense. Looks even that much bigger now. 2:56 to go.
OU has been recognized as having one of America's most beautiful campuses.
Tonight on ABC, a great in-state rivalry, Miami, then Florida State from Tallahassee. The Noles ranked 12th. That's at 8 Eastern time, 5 Pacific. Saturday Night Football on ABC, presented by Wells Fargo. Charlie Strong approaches in need of a big win, as is Al Golden. A chance for him to get that with Miami tonight. Second and 12. Ooh, Jonathan Gray ran into a wall at the 30-yard line that included Dominique Alexander and Hatari Bird. And Oklahoma uses its last timeout with 2:50 to go.
Coach Stoops went and talked to Hatari Bird during that timeout. He missed the tackle on Jonathan Gray on the long run. That time he did a great job of coming up and facing him up and getting him down.
Bob Stoops and the Sooners last year, number 4 in the country for a while. We talked early in the season. They looked like they had the makings of a team that could get into the first college football playoff. They ended up a disappointing 8-5. Made the coaching change that included Jay Norvell out the door. You have to give him a lot of credit now on the Texas sideline and calling the plays. They are pounding it on the ground. 53 runs to 12 passes, and it's worked very well.
And he's got a rhythm. And Sean, they're doing it with two true freshmen offensive line for Texas. Pahe, and also number 55 for the Texas offensive line, Connor Williams. They're doing a great job of opening up holes. And the thing is, Oklahoma knows that they're running the football and they can do nothing to stop them so far.
On the ground, Hurd! First down and more! And down in bounds at the 15-yard line. And that might put it into the win column for Texas.
Poise, control, making decisions. Hurd, watch the patience in letting the block set up. And this is something that you cannot teach a little burst through the hole, Todd.
Yeah, the speed to get outside and then the smarts to get down to keep this clock running. Really impressive from a freshman.
And to protect the football and not take an unnecessary hit.
14-yard gain. And you know, with all the problems on special teams in recent weeks, give them credit. They've been sound today. They didn't want to have the line up for a field goal, and they get a 10-point game. Now they're going to try to run out the clock. Jonathan Gray tackled by Dominique Alexander. Charlie Strong says we've had so many close calls. Lost by Cal by a point when they missed an extra point with under a minute and a half to go. Tied with Oklahoma State in the last minute. A problem on a punt. Set up a short field for the Cowboys. They kick the game-winning field goal in the final seconds. Can they finish with a minute 50 to go?
Just get the sense that all their frustration has been let out today, and this is what he's been looking for all year.
Gray again. Inside the 10, and the clock will run. Under a minute and a half to go. The Pacific Life game summary. Mayfield has put up big numbers in the second half. And Hurd, 166 total yards, most of that on the ground. He's rushed for 110 on 20 carries.
Yeah, and I'm also going to add Vance Bedford in that defense, slowing down a powerful Oklahoma offense, and especially the front seven of Texas has been outstanding today.
Game summary brought to you by Pacific Life. Hurd, take the reverse. Hurd slides down with another first down inside the 5-yard line. And now they can take a knee. What a remarkable turnaround for Texas. They lost 50-7 down the road in Fort Worth at TCU last weekend. They're waiting to celebrate with Charlie Strong crowding around their coach. And there it is. They never trailed in this game. There is a very good man and a very good football coach who's celebrating the biggest win of his time in Texas. Those players, Chris, understand what it means for Charlie Strong?
Not only for them, for Charlie and his staff, but for them. I mean, they were down, Sean. I mean, it was chaos. And they deserve that. I mean, you can say you're overreacting, but I don't think you're overreacting because they needed something good to happen. Now they can build on it.
And Oklahoma suffers its first loss of the season. They fall to 4-1. They lost 50-7 last week, and all of the stories in the aftermath were not just about how bad it was on the field, but the tweet at halftime, players apparently not getting along, although Charlie Strong said that was a bunch of nonsense we talked during the week. Even Bevo, the mascot, was deathly ill and did not make the trip. But Charlie Strong said all along, I believe we have a good team. We have to stop hurting ourselves. They played a terrific football game today and win the Red River Rivalry 24-17. Here's Todd McShay.
Coach, it's been a tough start to the season, but you get a huge win today against your rival Oklahoma. How good does this one feel?
I'm just so proud of our players and just how they came out and competed. And you look at it, Todd, it was just all week they hurt so much that they didn't have any pride in just the way they battled back. And I know this. I've been saying it. I just truly believe it. We have a good football team. We've lost some, and look at last week. I don't have an answer for last week coming back this week.
Well, we've talked the last 2 weeks about how studying the tape, you guys are a better team than the record shows. What was the difference today?
Well, it's just they just came together. And, you know, they hurt so much. And we just sat there and we, you know, we just talked about it. And I said to him, you know, at some point, we just got to go, guys, and we just got to play up to our ability.
Either you're sweating an awful lot or they got you with the Gatorade bath.
I think they got me with the Gatorade bath.
Congratulations, Coach.
Thank you.
They said we have to stop hurting ourselves. No turnovers today. Only 5 penalties. Each team had 5. He's been a part of some big wins in other spots. But I don't know if he's ever had a better feeling on a football field than that. Final score is Texas 24, Oklahoma 17. Coming up next on ABC, more college football, Georgia Tech, Clemson, or Wisconsin and Nebraska. Both games are available nationally. The game you're looking for isn't on ABC. Check out ESPN2. That's coming up next. Now for Todd McShay, Chris Beam, and our terrific crew, Sean McDonough, sending you back to the studio from Dallas, Texas.
Sean, thanks a lot, and what a difference a week can make, right? Well, for Dabo Swinney, he was just about as excited as Charlie Strong a week ago when they knocked off Notre Dame. Can he keep it going against Georgia Tech? When we come back, we'll get you ready for that one after this message and a word from our ABC stations. It's your Nissan Field Pass, a look at Tommy Armstrong Jr., the Nebraska Cornhuskers. A key matchup in the Big Ten facing Wisconsin. Wisconsin Badgers looking to stay above 500. And, of course, this one, Georgia Tech, is a big one coming up against Clemson. Big because the Clemson Tigers have their eyes on an ACC championship and perhaps even getting to the playoffs. John Saunders alongside of Mac Brown and Mark May, guys. And I'll start with you, Mac, because you've been there winning a game that you weren't expected to do in that Red River rivalry. And it certainly is exciting to do that. But for Charlie Strong, this one may mean even more.
It was a great win for Charlie. Those kids handled so much adversity last week, and adversity either pulls you together or splits you apart. And we know that, and I think Charlie and his staff did a tremendous job of pulling those guys together and getting after Oklahoma. And I'm sure Oklahoma watched the TCU film, and some of those guys didn't take Texas as serious as they could. Great win for Texas, and Charlie would tell you they could just as well be 4-2.
If you don't think that this means something to the fans of Texas, that they've given up on this football team, take a look back in Dallas again at the Cotton Bowl. The fans still staying there, standing and cheering, and Mayday from a player's standpoint. When you've been in that locker room and it seems like everyone has given up on the team, including some of the guys that are sitting right next to you in the locker room, how does it feel to suddenly turn it around and get it going this way?
Well, what a difference a week makes for this program. And what you do is you circle the wagons, John. It's everybody else, forget about them. It's us in this locker room, us against the world. We're going to have to figure out a way to win. And they did it the right way. Physically at the point of attack, they won the battle in the trenches. This is a team that rushed for over 300 yards, 58 rushing attempts. They only threw the ball 9 times. That tells me that's an attitude adjustment change this week. They decided to go out there and throw caution to the wind and say, you know what? We're going to hit you in the mouth, and we're going to find out who's standing in the 12th round.
They're actually shouting Charlie Strong's name from the rafters, and a week or so ago, they wanted to throw him over the rafters.
Yeah, well, last week they were shouting it, too.
Yeah.
I've had mine shouted each way, but this is a great win for Charlie Strong because this is the most important game to the Texas fans, period. And this should turn the corner for him and get him going.
You know, they do say in the Michigan-Ohio State rivalry that it doesn't matter what you do the rest of the season as long as you win that game. Is that true for Charlie? Will people forget the football this a week from now?
No, they'll love this till at least Tuesday. And then it's beat Kansas State and get back to it. But the thing that is important is that the players have been really abused. And people said they're no good and they don't try and they're losers and then the kids kind of split. This should validate the players to a point that they can go back and now be a football team moving forward and rally the Texas fans together instead of having a split group.
And head in the right direction, which is good news for Texas fans, a big win against Oklahoma. The Ohio